Buongiorno, buongiorno a tutti, un cordiale benvenuto a tutti. Ci siamo, scusate per questi 5 minuti di ritardo, ma aspettavamo le ultime connessioni. Una bella notizia, si è aggiunto il rappresentante della Turchia e quindi il seminario ha fatto l'amplein. Sono connessi tutti i rappresentanti delle istituzioni estere. Il mio benvenuto a tutti, lascerò poi per i saluti ufficiali agli organi della Fondazione. Da parte mia, un benvenuto ai rappresentanti delle istituzioni straniere che sono oggi connessi, alle istituzioni italiane naturalmente, e anche agli allievi e quindi ai protagonisti di questo importante corso che si è sviluppato nell'anno scorso. Sono collegati da remoto, gli mandiamo un saluto veramente cordiale e affettuoso, anche nel mio ruolo di coordinatore e diciamo da parte degli allievi e dei dipendenti della Fondazione. Io sono Marcello Minuti, sono il coordinatore della Fondazione. Il mio ruolo oggi sarà un ruolo di moderazione, di gestione dei tempi e quindi il mio compito sarà quello di passare la parola. Voglio solo spendere pochissime parole sull'importanza di questa giornata per noi, per la Fondazione, perché oggi chiudiamo un programma che è durato 5 mesi, è molto intenso, molto importante. Che ha visto impegnata tutta la Fondazione per circa un anno di lavoro. E quindi oggi è, diciamo così, la formale chiusura, ma soprattutto direi il momento di rilancio per porre le basi di un futuro di progetti di collaborazione tra l'Italia, il sistema culturale italiano e i paesi del Mediterraneo. Una breve indicazione su come funzionerà questa riunione, che è principalmente una riunione di lavoro, una prima sessione che inizia appena finirò io di parlare, prevede dei saluti istituzionali e quindi interverrà il direttore della Fondazione, l'architetto Alessandra Vittorini. Successivamente avremo il saluto della viceministra del Ministero degli Affari Esteri e della Cooperazione Internazionale, Marina Sereni. E infine il saluto di Ernesto Ottone Ramirez, Assistant Director General per la Cultura dell'UNESCO. A questa prima sessione di indirizzo seguirà una seconda sessione con gli interventi delle istituzioni italiane che hanno partecipato in qualità di enti ospitanti delle internship degli allievi dell'International School. Questa sessione sarà aperta da un intervento di inquadramento del presidente della Fondazione Vincenzo Trione e poi si succederanno 7 istituzioni italiane con i loro direttori nel racconto di quello che è stato, ma soprattutto con l'obiettivo di aprire il ventaglio sulle possibilità di collaborazione tra sistema culturale italiano e paesi esteri. A conclusione di questa sessione faremo vedere un brevissimo video di 2 minuti e poi avremo il piacere e l'onore di un intervento del ministro Dario Franceschini che ci raggiungerà durante la mattinata. È previsto il suo arrivo per le 11:20, 11:30. Questa seconda sessione terminerà per le ore 12 e avremo infine una sessione coordinata da Munir Bushnaki, che ringraziamo per questa generosa disponibilità, e quindi gli interventi dei direttori e dei ministeri delle istituzioni estere. Chiuderà infine il seminario, la cui chiusura è prevista per le 13:30, l'ambasciatore Andrea Meloni, che oltre ad essere un membro del consiglio di amministrazione della nostra fondazione, è il delegato delle attività internazionali e la persona che dall'inizio ha creduto e ideato questo importante progetto. Do brevemente qualche indicazione tecnica, abbiamo fatto già delle prove, quindi tutto dovrebbe funzionare, ma mi permetto di prendermi gli ultimi 2 minuti per ricordare che l'evento è in diretta. Noi che partecipiamo siamo su Zoom, ma abbiamo anche uno streaming video al quale si può accedere mediante l'indirizzo della Fondazione Scuolapatrimonio.it. È disponibile un'interpretazione simultanea in italiano, arabo ed inglese. Ciascuno di noi collegato su Zoom potrà selezionare in basso a destra, tramite l'icona a forma di mappamondo, la lingua desiderata. Tramite questo menu si potrà anche scegliere di non avere in sottofondo la lingua originale, se questa dà fastidio, e infine si può anche ascoltare solo l'originale selezionando off tra le impostazioni della lingua. Chiediamo a tutti di selezionare la qualità video in HD cliccando sul tasto Impostazioni, questo permetterà una migliore qualità del video. Indico infine che l'evento è registrato e quindi sarà messo a disposizione di tutti i partecipanti a questa riunione, naturalmente con le tre lingue di traduzione nei prossimi giorni, quindi avremo modo poi di condividere diciamo, questo evento post-prodotto. Penseremo noi dalla regia a disattivare e attivare i microfoni, così come a far scorrere eventuali slide per chi dei relatori le ha e ha richiesto questo nostro intervento. Ed infine chiedo, e questa è un'indicazione che ripeterò un paio di volte, veramente tutti di poter rispettare i tempi che abbiamo indicato e che di volta in volta cercherò di ricordare. Io mi fermo qui, ringrazio ancora tutti e cederei velocemente a questo punto la parola ad Alessandra Vittorini, direttore della nostra fondazione e che ringrazio per l'intervento.
Grazie, buongiorno, mi sentite? Salve, buongiorno a tutti. Sono lieta di dare il benvenuto per questo importante momento di confronto e di riflessione. Consentitemi di aprire con alcuni ringraziamenti alle tante persone che oggi, nei giorni, nei mesi scorsi, anche nel futuro, collaboreranno a queste iniziative, a partire dai vertici dei ministeri coinvolti, Ministero Beni Culturali e Ministero degli Affari Esteri. Avremo partecipanti oggi e li ringrazio davvero, il Ministro Dario Franceschini e la Vice Ministra Marina Sereni. E grazie alle strutture dei due ministeri che hanno sostenuto questa iniziativa e questa giornata, il Segretariato Generale del Ministero dei Beni Culturali, l'Ufficio Relazioni Internazionali, la Direzione Cooperazione allo Sviluppo e la Direzione Promozione Sistema Paese del Ministero degli Affari Esteri. Un ringraziamento doveroso va anche alla rappresentanza permanente italiana all'UNESCO, che ha fortemente supportato questo lavoro e la costruzione del programma. Grazie al direttore cultura dell'UNESCO, Ottone Ramirez, che parlerà a seguire, alle tante istituzioni italiane, i musei e i parchi archeologici che sono coinvolte nel programma e che siamo lieti oggi partecipano anche a questo importante momento di riflessione, a tutti i rappresentanti dei paesi esteri coinvolti che oggi ci onorano della loro presenza. Abbiamo una partecipazione davvero che fa onore allo sforzo profuso e anche all'importanza di questo momento. Grazie a tutti i partecipanti che hanno seguito la prima edizione del programma dell'International School e infine consentitemi di ringraziare la struttura della Fondazione che ci ha lavorato con tanto impegno e tanta passione evidente nei risultati e prima di tutto l'ambasciatore Meloni che, come è stato chiarito, chiuderà la giornata. Oggi è un momento importante di chiusura e di bilancio dell'esperienza condotta tra il 2019 e il 2020, ma anche di ridefinizione e di lancio di quelle che a partire da questa esperienza saranno le attività future. Solo due parole di richiamo su come si muove la Fondazione in questo campo. La Fondazione è nata con la specifica missione di strutturare nuove competenze di natura trasversale per affrontare e consentire di affrontare nel modo corretto le complessità che oggi ci chiede il lavoro sul patrimonio culturale. Lo fa a scala nazionale e a scala internazionale e attivando ogni possibile scambio e sinergia, come oggi vedremo. Il nostro compito non è e non è mai stato quello di formare specialisti, quello è compito di altre strutture, ma è quello di costruire un'offerta che si basi su un approccio multidisciplinare, creando reti tra istituzioni, connessioni tra discipline e favorendo la crescita di questo approccio e di una classe di operatori sul sistema culturale che possa valorizzare al meglio queste integrazioni. Gli obiettivi che a livello internazionale la scuola si propone di raggiungere e che questa attività svolta finora, il momento odierno, ci chiama a riflettere è la creazione di una piattaforma di scambio di esperienze, di formazione reciproca tra i sistemi culturali dell'Italia e degli altri paesi esteri. Come sapete, oggi il confronto è mirato sui paesi del Mediterraneo e sul tema della gestione dei siti e delle aree archeologiche. L'obiettivo di favorire lo sviluppo di relazioni per internazionalizzare il sistema culturale italiano. L'obiettivo di creare dei legami professionali e di trasferire le migliori esperienze italiane a favore degli stranieri, oggi ne parleremo. E oggi, in questa riflessione odierna, stiamo valutando e ragionando su come costruire ponti anche per ogni possibile futura relazione internazionale, sarà il tema che credo affronterà il presidente Trione nel suo intervento. Oltre a questa intensa attività avviata con l'International School, sono maturate in questi mesi, in questo periodo, una serie di altre attività di natura internazionale che coinvolgono la formazione e la ricerca con un ampio respiro. Parliamo di progetti europei, parliamo di analisi e studi di livello internazionale, un lavoro con i paesi dell'America Latina e tante altre iniziative, e le tante che nasceranno anche a partire da oggi. E qualche numero per chiarire che cosa è stata questa edizione e passare subito la parola a chi interverrà dopo di me. Nella prima edizione, come sapete, si è interessata all'area del Mediterraneo con un paese come partner associato, che è l'Etiopia, sul tema specifico della gestione dei musei e dei parchi archeologici. Sono stati coinvolti 11 paesi, 19 partecipanti di diverse tipologie di professionalità, archeologi, architetti, professionisti della gestione che operano nei ministeri, nei musei e nei parchi. Complessivamente sono state coinvolte 35 istituzioni italiane. Ha visto questo programma 5 mesi di lavoro, 2 a Roma e 3 nelle sedi delle istituzioni archeologiche italiane, 27 casi di studio presi in esame, 150 ore di lezione, 50 esperti italiani ed esteri coinvolti. Oggi ci aspettiamo da questa giornata di fare, come era previsto, una riunione di lavoro operativa, ma anche di raccogliere indicazioni, di progettare i futuri interventi di cooperazione che speriamo possano arricchire il bagaglio di competenze sia sul fronte italiano che sul fronte dei paesi stranieri coinvolti, per porre le basi che è la nostra missione costante in tutti i campi, anche nelle attività locali, nazionali e di settore, porre le basi per un linguaggio comune che possa essere utile al lavoro, al dialogo e allo scambio su scala internazionale. Io chiudo qui, passo la parola al ricco programma di interventi, ringrazio davvero tutti i partecipanti e con i migliori auguri di buon lavoro. Grazie a tutti.
Grazie direttore. Andrei velocemente alla vice ministra Marina Sereni, che ringrazio, siamo onorati della sua presenza, signora vice ministra. Voglio solo dire una parola sull'importanza del sostegno che abbiamo avuto sin dall'inizio del Ministero degli Affari Esteri e la cooperazione internazionale, sia grazie al supporto dell'ufficio della rappresentanza permanente presso l'UNESCO, sia da parte delle due direzioni che ci hanno sostenuto e ci sostengono, e cioè la Direzione Generale Promozione del Sistema Paese e la Direzione Generale Cooperazione allo Sviluppo. Prego, Vice Ministra.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, I prepared my speech. And it will be, I will go on with the English. Okay. Thank you, Director. A warm welcome on behalf of the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation to all the esteemed participants of today's seminar. We are at the final step of a program centered on two long-standing priorities of Italy. That is the Mediterranean area and culture, in today's case, archaeology. I will not dwell on the importance of the Mediterranean for our country. It is self-evident from any point of view. The Italian government is fully engaged in reinforcing our ties with the countries of the area. And I am convinced that initiatives of cultural cooperation, such as the one carried out by the International School of Cultural Heritage, represents another precious signal of our commitment, a commitment that we are happy to share with UNESCO, and I warmly welcome the participation in this seminar of Assistant Director General Ottoni. Italy is supporting archaeological, ethno-anthropological and conservation missions worldwide as an instrument to enhance relations between states and in the perspective of cooperation in the cultural field. In this framework, we supported the 2019-2020 program offered by the International School of Cultural Heritage, that, as mentioned before, has been mainly aimed at the Mediterranean countries, where most of the Italian archaeological missions abroad operate. Their work is focused on promoting the study, conservation, and enhancement of the local cultural heritage by creating cultural and scientific exchanges with the host countries and by fostering the training of local personnel. In the students' countries of region, the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs assists archaeological, paleontological, ethno-anthropological, and restoration and conservation missions that pertain to the different thematic and chronological areas in the respective disciplines. Our support is based on interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary approach, aimed at fostering fruitful cooperation with scholars, researchers, institutions, students, and social realities of the host countries. In addition, a particular attention is reserved to the commitment of many missions through the so-called green clauses to the projects of CO2 compensation in accordance with the sustainable development goals enshrined in the United Nations 2030 agenda. Despite the threat posed by the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, the Italian missions have been able to continue their research both on the ground and from afar, in collaboration with local institutions and with the full support of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation. These missions represent not only scientific and study activities of great importance, they are as well as valuable tool for training local operators and for technology transfer in many fields, such as archaeology, restoration and protection of cultural heritage, all sectors in which Italy ranks at an international level a recognized excellence. In this regard, Italy is deeply convinced that the protection and safeguarding of cultural heritage, both tangible and intangible, are of paramount importance for humankind and represent a fundamental tool for dialogue and inclusion and therefore peace. As a matter of fact, our country has a long tradition and increasing experience in the fields of cultural heritage protection, conservation and restoration, contrast to illicit trafficking of cultural property. Italy is in the forefront of international activities in these fields, especially through the commendable programs carried out by the Carabinieri Special Unit for the Protection of Cultural Heritage and in the response to natural calamities. Being convinced of the usefulness of programs such as the one we are examining today, and of its importance in terms of helping in establishing precious networks of contacts among scholars and students, thus paving the way for a future of reinforced cooperation, I'm looking forward for the results of today's seminar. I thank you.
Grazie Vice Ministra, grazie davvero. A questo punto introdurrei Ernesto Ottone Ramirez, che è Assistant Director General for Culture dell'UNESCO. Ricordo solo che tutto iniziò da un forte incoraggiamento dell'UNESCO. 2 anni fa circa l'ambasciatore Meloni ebbe un incontro con Ottone Ramirez e in questo incontro il dottor Ottone Ramirez ci incoraggiò su questa linea di attività. Quindi oggi è anche un po' responsabilità sua se siamo qui. Lo ringrazio a nome di noi tutti e gli cedo volentieri la parola, sperando che la sua linea di indirizzo possa anche tracciare delle linee di cooperazione tra la Fondazione e il Sistema Italia sempre più forti e l'UNESCO. Grazie.
Grazie, grazie. So I will speak in English. My Italian is not so good, so sorry. Marina Sereni, Vice Minister of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation, Alessandra Vitorini, Director, Fondazione Scuola dei Beni e delle Attività Culturali, Ambassador Meloni, Excellencies, Ladies and Gentlemen. First of all, it's my great pleasure to join you today for the final online seminar of the Managing Mediterranean Archaeological Heritage Challenges and Strategies program. I would first like to thank the National School of Cultural Heritage for leading this ambitious training program, which focused on the management and enhancement of archaeological sites and museums. I also want to take this opportunity to extend my sincere gratitude to the Ambassador Massimo Riccardo and the Permanent Delegation of Italy to UNESCO for inviting me to participate to this important seminar. Well, as you know, the Mediterranean region is rich in cultural heritage and hosts some of the world's most visited archaeological sites, several of which are inscribed on the World Heritage List. The museum in the region play a key role in preserving and sharing archaeological subjects, as well as promoting education and knowledge about the region's outstanding heritage. Safeguarding, managing, and promoting these sites and museums goes to the heart of UNESCO's mission. Archaeological sites hold deep meaning for humanity, oftentimes for different reasons. From scientists and archaeologists to local population, visitors, and for sure, national authorities. Recognizing these different needs and value is vital to safeguarding these sites for the future and for next generation. The intrinsic importance and fit nature of archaeological resources have been recognized in various international charters, including the UNESCO Convention concerning the protection of the World Heritage Cultural and Natural Heritage of the 72 Convention. In recent years, we have seen growing threats to sites in the Mediterranean region. These include rapid urbanization, environment degradation, the extraordinary growth of mass tourism, natural disasters, climate change, violent conflicts, and in some countries, a lack of resources for continuous maintenance and conservation. We cannot forget that archaeological sites are non-renewable resources, making their sustainability management maintenance essential. UNESCO promotes the protection of archaeological heritage through the coordinated management of its use, whether for research, education, or tourism. For any site, a systematic planning process must be established that takes into consideration available resources, local national laws, and the values the sites hold for interested stakeholders, including local communities living around these sites. Today, the world is facing an unprecedented crisis with the COVID-19 pandemic. COVID-19 has seen the closure of many archaeological sites and museums. 30% of World Heritage sites remain closed today, and that at the worst peak of the pandemic, there were 92% of all sites closed. As a result, tourist revenues have rapidly declined, impacting local communities and national economies. Exposing the intrinsic link between cultural heritage and local economies. As sites begin to reopen in some regions of the world, the situation remains volatile, with different countries and regions experiencing different challenges. New measures, approaches are being tested to open sites for visitors and to restart tourism. At the same time, the crisis is forcing us to reflect on sustainable strategies and resilience and approach for the future management of these sites. A key emerging trend is the increasing use of digital technologies for shaping the future of heritage and tourism. Many archaeological sites are implementing and exploring digital innovation, which can contribute to improving the monitoring, conservation, and sustainable management of those sites. At the same time, we must recognize COVID-19 has in many ways deepened the digital divide, and that digital technologies are not a one-size-fits-all solutions. No, more than ever, it is necessary to foster collaboration, as you are doing it right now, in order to respond to the current challenges facing archaeological heritage. I have no doubt that the knowledge, skill, good practices that were exchanged during this two-year training program will help us to strengthen the management of the Mediterranean cultural heritage. UNESCO, and the institute that you know, is committed to work alongside you in this effort. I look forward to a very successful seminar, and I want to thank you all for collaborating with this great challenge that are for humanity. Thank you so much.
Grazie, Assistant Director General, grazie davvero. Parole veramente molto incoraggianti e che ci, posso dire, ci responsabilizzano ancora di più per il futuro. Si chiude a questo punto la prima sessione e direi che possiamo passare velocemente alla seconda sessione della riunione. Come sappiamo, adesso sarà il turno delle istituzioni italiane, a cui chiediamo appunto un bilancio, seppur breve, nel poco tempo che abbiamo sull'esperienza vissuta e idee sul futuro da fare insieme con i paesi stranieri. La sessione è introdotta dal presidente della nostra fondazione, che è Vincenzo Trione, che ringrazio e a cui cedo immediatamente la parola. Grazie, presidente.
Ringrazio il dottor Minuti, ringrazio la direttrice Alessandra Vittorini e ringrazio tutti gli ospiti. Ma soprattutto vi ringrazio per la fiducia che avete riposto nella scuola. Per 5 mesi avete inviato i vostri funzionari investendo sulla loro crescita professionale in Italia. Vi ringrazio per essere qui a parlare di ciò che abbiamo fatto insieme, ma anche, forse soprattutto, dell'avvenire, delle iniziative congiunte che potremmo avviare. Il termine che ritornerà più frequentemente nel mio intervento sarà proprio insieme. Il metodo per immaginare le forme di collaborazione futura, credo, possa essere lo stesso di quello che abbiamo utilizzato per definire il programma dello scorso anno. Un dialogo costante per individuare sulla base delle vostre priorità, delle nostre competenze, i contenuti e le forme di collaborazione possibili. Lo scorso anno siamo ricorsi alla mediazione preziosa delle rappresentanze permanenti presso UNESCO, che ringrazio. Ora desidereremo avviare con voi un dialogo diretto. Rispetto al 2019, però, molti paradigmi culturali, antropologici, conoscitivi e comportamentali sono stati radicalmente messi in crisi dalla pandemia. Per il mondo che viene, potremmo muoverci su 2 livelli temporali. Nel breve termine, nei prossimi mesi, saremo costretti a porci dentro i limiti che impone la pandemia stessa e a studiare insieme cosa sarà possibile fare da remoto. Credo che possa rappresentare un'opportunità anche per superare tanti pregiudizi nei confronti del web. Per questa fase, noi poniamo alla vostra attenzione, come offerta iniziale, l'organizzazione di webinar, innanzitutto su 4 macro aree tematiche, relative alle sfide poste dalla cura e dalla gestione dei musei e dei parchi archeologici. Inviterei la regia a mostrare la slide che avevo predisposto. La seconda slide, prego. Tutela, conservazione e ricerca, strumenti di gestione, musei, parchi archeologici e comunità, musei, parchi archeologici e contesti ambientali e paesaggistici. Dunque, restauro, conservazione, protezione, museografia, tutela. Si tratta di alcuni dei settori nei quali l'Italia è senza ombra di dubbio un'eccellenza a livello internazionale. Ma non solo. La pandemia e l'intervento che mi ha preceduto già aperto uno squarcio in questa direzione ci obbliga a ripensare anche alla funzione del web e dei social, che a lungo i musei e i siti archeologici spesso hanno utilizzato come vetrine dove postare iniziative, collezioni, mostre, eventi. E ora, i musei e i siti archeologici commetterebbero un grave errore se tornassero al pre-Covid. Chiamati a ripensarsi adesso, dovranno provare a saldare esperienze online con esperienze offline. Perciò dovranno investire competenze, tempo ed energia per sviluppare ulteriormente anche le opportunità della rete, arricchendo piattaforme, siti e social di archivi digitali, di apparati ipertestuali, di app, di sperimentazioni legate al virtuale, alla realtà aumentata. Potrebbero avviare anche programmi di didattica e-learning, i famosi MOOC, che consentono una diversa fruizione a distanza delle opere d'arte e dei siti archeologici. Dunque, i temi della valorizzazione, della digitalizzazione e della comunicazione. Ma veniamo al secondo livello di intervento temporale. Quando sarà possibile riprendere contatti diretti, saremo chiamati a puntare su tecnologie che ci consentano di lavorare a distanza, ma, mi verrebbe da dire finalmente, potremo tornare a pensare anche a forme ibride, blended. Per questa fase siamo interessati a conoscere il vostro parere almeno su due aspetti nodali. Se esiste un vostro interesse per progettare una nuova edizione del programma dello scorso anno, e con quali modifiche, e se siete interessati a lavorare insieme con noi per costruire gradualmente una rete che permetta di rafforzare le capacità professionali di coloro che hanno la responsabilità nel gestire musei e siti archeologici, valorizzandone anche il patrimonio. Una rete, e con questo concludo, che colleghi i grandi istituti specializzati nel restauro, i musei, i siti archeologici italiani, le università, gli enti di ricerca, il mondo della scienza, dell'innovazione tecnologica e il mondo della comunicazione. Mi auguro che questo metodo di lavoro e queste proposte incontrino il vostro interesse. Saremo molto attenti ad ascoltare i vostri commenti e le vostre suggestioni nella sessione che tra poco si aprirà. Colgo l'occasione per ringraziare l'ambasciatore Andrea Meloni, che è stato autentico Virgilio in questa iniziativa, sin dall'apertura dell'avventura della Scuola del Patrimonio. Lo so, con la direttrice Vittorini, con l'ambasciatore Meloni, siamo consapevoli che questo è un progetto ambizioso, volto a intrecciare ricerca, gestione, valorizzazione e turismo. Ma siamo consapevoli che solo puntando su forme innovative e appunto ambiziose riusciremo ad affrontare insieme le sfide che ci attendono. È una fase storica, in qualche modo epocale, nella quale abbiamo bisogno di coraggio, di immaginazione, di visionarietà, ma soprattutto di condivisione. Solo condividendo mondi, culture e buone pratiche potremo vincere insieme la sfida che siamo chiamati ad affrontare oggi. Grazie.
Grazie molte, Presidente Trione. A questo punto è il turno delle istituzioni italiane. In ordine Zuchtriegel, Fassone, Barni, Nizzo, Quilici, Miliani e Bazzoli. Introduco quindi immediatamente Pestum. Pestum è uno dei più importanti parchi archeologici italiani, in Campania, nella regione Campania. È diretto da un direttore che è qui collegato, che è Gabriel Zuchtriegel. A Pestum ha lavorato per 3 mesi Aysar Al-Radaideh, che è il nostro partecipante dalla Giordania, e si è occupato di monitoraggio sismico, di miglioramento dell'accessibilità e di altri temi legati a questo sul Tempio di Nettuno. Gabriel Zutkriger ci parlerà di archeologia circolare, quindi lascerò a lui la parola chiedendo il rispetto dei 5 minuti. Grazie.
Okay, good morning everybody. I prepared my presentation in English, so I speak in English. First of all, I would like to express my gratitude to the International School and to all of you for organizing this stimulating meeting. I will not take much time. Essentially, what I would like to share with you is our experience with regard to the question of how cultural heritage challenges and strategies relate to local communities. As you know, the Faro Convention attributes a crucial value role to what it defines heritage communities. And in our joint project with the foundation, both the one with the Italian scholar Paola Contursi and with Mohammed, who has just been mentioned, this was at the center of our activity. The question we started from was, to whom belong the temples of Paestum? Who is entitled to tell the history of this site? And what we wanted to do is to open a perspective on heritage management and participation, visitor services, outreach, that goes beyond the juridical notion of ownership. The temples and the other monuments, of course, are owned by the Italian state, nation, and managed and protected through the Italian government and Ministry of Culture, to which the archaeological park belongs. However, it has increasingly become clear that state intervention must seek support from local communities in order to implement an effective system of antiquities protection, conservation, and management. Thus, we tried to engage with local groups and in one of the projects, which was called Paestum Invita, Paestum Invites, and at the same time, it life, we tried to organize meetings. We organized meetings with local groups and are trying to make their voices emerge also in the official representation of the museum, for example, on the social media and also in the museum tour. I think in this context, the reform of the Italian state museums and archaeological parks in 2015 has been crucial. It created museums and parks with a relatively high degree of autonomy. This is very important because it enabled us to increase also the dialogue with the local communities. So to explain what this can mean concretely for the management, protection, and public outreach, I just wanted to briefly show you, talk about the project which has been mentioned already, the seismic monitoring of the Neptune Temple, which I show you here. I'm actually here on the site, so I wanted to show it to you directly, but the internet connection is not so good. So what we did was, together with the University of Salerno, we developed a cutting-edge monitoring system technology that allows us to observe in real time the dynamic behavior of the building. So this includes not only movements during earthquakes, but also the impact of the weather, climate change, especially the wind, rain, human activities such as car and train traffic on the building. We now actually can measure vibrations of the building created, for example, by a train passing in some distance, a kilometer or so. And this helps us to understand the inner structure of the building and to prevent damage in the future. To fund the project, we use the platform ArtBonus, which is developed by the Italian government and Ministry of Culture, and permits to promote fundraising campaigns for cultural heritage, granting to donors tax reliefs up to 65%. And we actually collected the whole budget with that from local companies and donors. So this is another level of dialogue with the local communities. The raw data, so the vibrations, the movement of the temple will be made available in real time on the internet. So you will be able to connect yourself from any point in the world and see how the temple is moving, obviously micro movements. And the elaborated data sets will be available on request for free for any research institute worldwide that is interested in working on them. At the same time, new excavations going on right now here below my office in the park, in order to position the sensors and other things related to this project, created additional attention. And so what we are seeing is that research and new insight create further awareness and ultimately enhance our standing. And this helps us obviously to collect more funding and to also increase visitor numbers. Therefore, we have begun to think of archaeology here and cultural heritage management at Pestement Velia as a circular practice, so to speak, circular archaeology. Like there's a circular economy, there's also circular archaeology, and this means protection, research, visitor services, and fundraising form a circle in which one element supports and helps the other. Thank you for your attention.
Grazie mille direttore, grazie per il lavoro che stai facendo, grazie per il supporto e veramente la disponibilità per ogni nostra chiamata. A questo punto passerei alla seconda istituzione, che non sta naturalmente a me presentarla, parliamo del Museo delle Antichità Egizie di Torino. In questo importante museo hanno fatto la loro esperienza di internship i nostri partecipanti dall'Egitto, Ahmed, Yasser e Mohammed. Si sono occupati naturalmente di tutto quello che riguarda la gestione museale, quindi hanno esercitato il loro lavoro sui temi della collection management, della mediazione culturale, della ricerca sulle collezioni. Oggi a raccontarci tutto questo c'è Alessia Fassone, che è il curatore, uno dei curatori del museo e responsabile delle attività didattiche. Prego Alessia.
Buongiorno a tutti, naturalmente porto i saluti del direttore Cristian Greco, che stamattina non può essere con noi perché è impegnato tra l'altro in un rapporto di lavoro e di un importante progetto proprio con l'Egitto. Naturalmente ci tiene a esprimere la sua vicinanza e la sua felicità anche nel aver fatto parte di questo progetto in cui siamo stati tutti coinvolti a livello di staff e a livello di museo. È stato per noi importante poter mostrare a dei colleghi egiziani con cui noi abbiamo dei rapporti costanti sia dal punto di vista dello studio e della ricerca sia anche per quello che è il lavoro che il museo svolge sul campo in Egitto nella missione archeologica congiunta con l'Eiden a Saqqara e ovviamente per il nostro impegno in quello che è la conservazione di un patrimonio comune. Il bene archeologico che noi conserviamo nel nostro museo formalmente di proprietà della Repubblica Italiana, ma essendo un bene proveniente dall'Egitto, per noi è importante ribadire che è un bene comune, che è anche un bene egiziano. I colleghi egiziani che con noi hanno trascorso un periodo purtroppo improvvisamente interrotto hanno trovato molto interesse nella forma di gestione del Museo Egizio, che come saprete è una realtà ibrida, molto particolare, sperimentale. Quindi da una parte abbiamo la presenza dello Stato con una collezione appartenente alla Repubblica e con tutto quello che concerne la tutela, la conservazione e la valorizzazione che è in capo al Ministero. Da parte nostra, a livello di gestione, ci occupiamo di una parte di management molto importante che quindi ha visto anche un grande interesse da parte dei colleghi proprio per il rapporto che lega un'istituzione a gestione privata con il pubblico. Quindi questo è stato un elemento estremamente interessante, un elemento di condivisione e che ci ha permesso di scambiare idee molto molto interessanti su questo punto. Tra gli uffici coinvolti all'interno della nostra, del nostro lavoro e quindi anche di quella che è stata la narrazione ai colleghi c'è stato l'ufficio comunicazione e l'ufficio marketing, laddove le nostre strategie comunicative sui social o con i mezzi più tradizionali o nell'apertura nei confronti del pubblico sono state particolarmente valorizzate. Abbiamo naturalmente coinvolto i colleghi in tutto quello che era il procedimento del nostro lavoro curatoriale che loro conoscono molto bene, quindi sia nella parte di legata alla conservazione dei reperti, al loro studio e alla ricerca su di essi, naturalmente anche in tutto quello che è il discorso espositivo, quindi come valorizzare questi reperti all'interno di una collezione permanente e all'interno anche di quelle che sono le mostre temporanee. È stato particolarmente apprezzato tutto il discorso di ricerca scientifica che c'è collateralmente alla ricerca umanistica, quindi una ricerca di tipo tecnico, fisico, chimico e tutte quelle analisi che noi chiamiamo archeometriche che ci permettono di conoscere più in profondità, al di là del visibile, il nostro patrimonio archeologico. Quindi tutto ciò che è legato alla documentazione, documentazione d'archivio, documentazione dello scavo, documentazione della collezione è stato particolarmente apprezzato e anche su questo punto abbiamo avuto moltissimi elementi di scambio e di confronto, in particolare per quanto riguarda proprio la valorizzazione dei siti archeologici, che è nella maggior parte dei casi elemento su cui lavorano proprio i colleghi che hanno avuto a che fare con noi. Certamente tutto un discorso museologico è interessante per le potenzialità che l'esposizione permette, soprattutto in uno spazio vasto e poliedrico come quello del Museo Egizio, e abbiamo cercato di coinvolgere, anzi li abbiamo coinvolti in maniera massiccia su alcuni progetti di inclusione sociale e in particolare con comunità locali di studenti anche di origine egiziana, e il loro apporto in questo devo dire è stato fondamentale. Lavoriamo moltissimo con migranti, giovani, con adolescenti, con adulti, e il nostro scopo è esattamente quello di far percepire alle comunità locali, italiane e straniere, quindi anche i nuovi italiani di origine arabofona o egiziana, che questo patrimonio è comune e che il museo è un posto comune per tutti, aperto a tutti, dove tutti possono dare il proprio apporto. Speriamo quindi per un futuro naturalmente di poter riprendere il discorso laddove è stato interrotto in maniera improvvisa da questa emergenza pandemica. Siamo disponibili naturalmente a andare incontro a quelle che sono state le manifestazioni di interesse da parte dei colleghi egiziani e quindi a ricalibrare anche la nostra narrazione del museo e a presentare loro maggiormente il lavoro che viene fatto anche in Egitto. Questo per noi è molto importante perché ribadisce una collaborazione e una costante, un costante scambio di idee proprio con le istituzioni dell'Egitto. Ci tengo quindi a salutare con estremo piacere i colleghi e soprattutto i rappresentanti del Ministero dell'Egitto qua presenti oggi e naturalmente tutti i colleghi che hanno partecipato a questa avventura di cui gli ospiti egiziani spesso ci parlavano con grande entusiasmo. Speriamo di aver fatto apprezzare loro l'Italia e Torino e speriamo di poterla valorizzare ancora di più nel futuro. Grazie a tutti.
Lo speriamo anche noi. Ringrazio da parte della Fondazione Alessia Fassone, ti preghiamo di ringraziare anche il direttore Cristian Greco, il vostro supporto è sempre fondamentale per noi.
Glielo quindi riferirò, gli farà molto piacere.
Grazie, grazie. A questo punto ci sarà un intervento di Giovanna Barni, che è il co-presidente dell'Alleanza Cooperativa Italiana e Cultura. Giovanna Barni, buongiorno Giovanna. Rappresenta le aziende cooperative. Il sistema italiano è un sistema complesso in cui intervengono operatori pubblici, il Ministero, gli enti locali, le associazioni, le cooperative e le aziende. Devo dire che i nostri partecipanti hanno espresso una grande curiosità per la complessità di questo sistema e quindi lascio la parola a Giovanna Barni chiedendo un intervento che focalizzi quale può essere il ruolo del privato in un settore appunto di questo tipo. Grazie.
Sì, grazie Marcello, buongiorno a tutti. È stato un piacere l'anno scorso contribuire al programma. Evidentemente eravamo in un'epoca molto distante da quella che stiamo vivendo adesso, dalla crisi caratterizzata dalla crisi della pandemia, un'epoca molto distante nella quale noi abbiamo voluto apportare soprattutto dal lato appunto di chi offre servizi e attività al pubblico per il patrimonio culturale. Abbiamo voluto offrire un contributo di concretezza rispetto a una serie di strumenti, a una serie di nuovi sistemi, piattaforme che possono contribuire alla fruizione del patrimonio culturale, piattaforme che si occupano di gestire tutta la customer journey, o piattaforme, strumenti come che utilizzano le nuove tecnologie come la realtà virtuale, la realtà aumentata, ma che in qualche modo possono attingere dalla competenza dell'impresa che si è occupata sempre di cultura, delle competenze che non sono quelle soltanto informatiche, ma sono competenze necessarie ad una tecnologia che sia al servizio della persona, al servizio del visitatore e al servizio di un patrimonio culturale tipicamente diffuso e quindi che mettano per esempio in connessione piattaforme digitali, che mettano in connessione i musei con il territorio, le terme di Caracalla per esempio con il Museo Archeologico Nazionale di Napoli attraverso appunto la realtà virtuale. Quindi una innovazione tecnologica che non è solo informatica, non è solo tecnologia, ma è al servizio della persona. La crisi pandemica, questi sono i nostri interventi dello scorso anno. Questa è un'ipotesi di piattaforma che segue tutto il servizio al visitatore dal momento in cui si informa ancora da casa fino al momento in cui in qualche modo visita, fruisce, accede al museo, appunto la realtà virtuale. Ecco, la crisi pandemica ha in qualche modo reso ancora più urgente non solo l'incontro tra tecnologia e patrimonio culturale e la fruizione culturale, ma ha reso ancora più urgente, a nostro avviso, anche un incontro con una accelerazione del ruolo sociale che possono svolgere, che può svolgere il patrimonio culturale. Perché in qualche modo siamo di fronte a una crisi non solo economica, ma anche sociale, dove abbiamo visto che la cultura effettivamente può essere importantissima per ricostruire un'identità, per ricostruire socializzazione, per anche ricostruire un'economia. È stata citata l'economia circolare dopo la crisi. Ecco, quello che potremmo ancora dare come contributo in questo momento come impresa, come sistema della cooperazione culturale italiana, è soprattutto un contributo ad un approccio di innovazione sociale, cioè un approccio che renda il patrimonio culturale sempre più smart, cioè sempre più accessibile e sicuro, perché va ricostruito il legame fra i cittadini, i turisti e i luoghi, va reso più sicuro l'accesso, più accogliente rispetto a quanto poteva essere prima, un ruolo sociale che significa anche una maggiore legame fra il patrimonio culturale, le comunità locali, le città, i territori, quindi in questo senso un patrimonio culturale che si apre sempre più all'esterno. Gli studenti l'anno scorso hanno visitato la Valle dei Templi, sono stati anche con noi, che siamo uno dei soggetti, degli attori che collabora alla Valle dei Templi, ad Agrigento, e il modello di Agrigento è un modello inclusivo, È un modello dove convivono, oltre all'ente parco, anche degli attori diversi. Alcuni valorizzano le risorse naturali, gli olivi, gli aranceti della Valle dei Templi. Noi valorizziamo la parte praticamente di culturale, nel senso promuoviamo attività ed eventi culturali e tutto il sistema di accoglienza. Quindi è un modello inclusivo dove si costruiscono, dove il patrimonio culturale diventa hub di comunità. E quindi anche in questo caso occorrono competenze innovative che sono quelle, per esempio, del community engagement, dei partenariati pubblico-privati, dove appunto il patrimonio culturale, nella gestione del patrimonio culturale, per la messa a valore di tutte le potenzialità che il patrimonio culturale offre, sono coinvolti soggetti diversi. Ed infine io direi, oltre che smart, quindi un patrimonio più sicuro, un patrimonio più accessibile, un patrimonio più inclusivo, anche un modello più sostenibile, che non è altro che l'ipotesi che dal patrimonio culturale possa sorgere una grande opportunità per uno sviluppo sostenibile dei territori. È una chance che tutti i paesi del Mediterraneo hanno, ed è importantissimo, secondo me, anche la connessione fra questo programma e la cooperazione allo sviluppo. Per un modello sostenibile, il valore in un modello sostenibile, la possibilità di valore anche economico, oltre che sociale, che scaturisce, che è generato dal patrimonio culturale, è distribuito in una filiera territoriale molto più ampia. Anche qui sostenibilità significa integrazione, significa rete, significa filiera territoriale ed economia circolare. Ho citato queste cose per dire che queste sono competenze innovative, non solo tecnologiche, e questo è un po' quello, il senso del mio intervento, ma sono competenze multidisciplinari, sono competenze ibride. E questa è la grande sfida, secondo me, nella quale evidentemente l'arricchimento che può venire dai cittadini, dalle comunità locali, dalle imprese, rispetto a quelle che sono le competenze anche più tradizionali sul patrimonio culturale, è molto importante. I luoghi di formazione, e credo che questo sia importante per il lavoro che abbiamo, quel piccolo lavoro che abbiamo già iniziato insieme alla Scuola del Patrimonio, che io ringrazio moltissimo, anche i luoghi di formazione non possono che essere luoghi ibridi, luoghi di contaminazione. Ho apprezzato questa possibilità di scambiare con operatori di tutto il bacino del Mediterraneo competenze, e quindi in qualche modo contaminarci reciprocamente. Luoghi di formazione dove convivono centri di ricerca, università, la Scuola del Patrimonio, eccetera. Concludo dicendo quindi che probabilmente la sfida della pandemia richiede urgentemente un grande investimento nel capitale umano per tutte le sfide che il patrimonio culturale ha davanti, sfide che appunto ci piacerebbe poter percorrere insieme. Grazie ancora.
Grazie Giovanna Barni. Nel frattempo si è unito alla riunione il ministro Dario Franceschini, gli diamo il buongiorno, il benvenuto e siamo naturalmente onorati della sua presenza. Il ministro parlerà da programma dopo i prossimi 4 interventi. Andiamo subito all'intervento di Valentino Nizzo, direttore del Museo Etrusco di Villa Giulia a Roma, il più importante certamente museo etrusco italiano. A Villa Giulia ha lavorato Nian, la partecipante dall'Iraq che si è occupata di gestione e valorizzazione dei depositi. Prego Valentino Nizzo.
Thank you, Marcello. As Marcello already said, the Villa Giulia Museum was born in 1889 in one of the most representative Roman villas of Renaissance. Its collection of works of art and objects from the daily life of the Etruscans is the most important in the world. The Etruscans were the most powerful civilization in pre-Roman Italy and one of the most influential in the Mediterranean. From the 8th century BC onward, they were among the protagonists of the so-called Orientalizing Revolution, which favored the import of cultural models and prestigious goods from Egypt, the Near East, and the Phoenician world. The collaboration with countries that have been among the main promoters of this ancient revolution is therefore an important stimulus, which fosters the creation of fruitful collaboration from historical, artistic, and archaeological perspectives too. The mission of Villa Giulia Museum includes promoting Etruscan civilization in its Mediterranean dimension. This goal is achieved by taking care of the collections from the point of view of conservation, as well as communication to all sorts of public, not neglecting interdisciplinary studies and research through the use of the most advanced technologies applied to archaeology and museology. The museum has an important conservation section and, in collaboration with the National Institute of Nuclear Physics, houses a laboratory equipped for cutting-edge investigation on compositional analysis of metal alloys, as well as production techniques and the state of conservation of metal finds. Conservation, teaching, accessibility, and communication are some of the fields in which the museum has developed excellent skills that can be made available to all interested partners through information activities and collaboration with the goal to bring about concrete initiatives. Has already happened with the enthusiastic participation in our activities of Nian Nasir Hama Hassan. Additionally, the museum is committed to engaging the partners in workshops on specific issues of mutual interest, including classes of materials such as ceramics, jewelry, and bronzes, in order to enhance the cultural and commercial relationships that involved our countries throughout their millenary history. Eventually, this shared work could result in traveling exhibition as well as further promotional projects, possibly even virtual. As for conservation, the museum is willing to train the scientific staff of the partners through both on-site fieldwork and online activities, and to offer specific advice and favor the exchange of ideas and technical scientific support for setting up restoration laboratories. Further possible collaboration concerns the themes of universal accessibility, physical, cognitive, and cultural. Villa Giulia is happy to share practical and theoretical training courses with the partners on the adaptation of the available spaces to physical and visual accessibility, on the reception of disabled people, and on the planning of dedicated activities for them. After examining the peculiarities of the collection of the sites involved, the museum can help the partners to identify the most appropriate teams and offer indication to make them accessible to the disabled through the use of either authentic objects or copies or other media that favor the cultural enjoyment of blind people. Finally, the major focus of the museum section is sharing good practices and application models of the principles of the Convention on the Value of Cultural Heritage for Society, FARO Convention. The universal right to cultural heritage can in fact be exercised through forms of sharing that encourage the active participation of the public, making it a driving force of development and growth. In fact, the active participation in the cultural promotion becomes a strategic tool for fostering social inclusion and cohesion, also and especially in a perspective of intercultural collaboration, such as that pursued by the International School of Cultural Heritage. Thank you for your attention.
Grazie Valentino Nizzo, grazie per il tuo lavoro, grazie per la disponibilità, grazie per la tenuta dei tempi. A questo punto andrei direttamente a Simone Quilici. Simone Quilici è il direttore di un altro importante parco archeologico italiano, Sui Generis. È un parco, forse l'unico caso al mondo, Simone, di un parco archeologico inserito in una metropoli. All'Appia Antica hanno svolto la internship i partecipanti dalla Palestina, Mohamed Khalil e Rabia Arrak dal Marocco. si sono occupati Hamed sul progetto, su tutte le questioni di restauro e accessibilità al parco, e Rabia invece ha fatto un lavoro molto importante di studio dell'applicazione delle leggi italiane, del codice dei beni culturali, per poi portare a casa una conoscenza e lavorare sulla revisione normativa in Marocco. Do il benvenuto a Simone Quilici, a cui passo immediatamente la parola. Grazie.
Good morning and thank you for the kind invitation. I try to speak with my rusty English, and so I would like to start by saying that I'm very honored to be here today at this seminar focusing on possible twinnings and skills sharing with our international partners. Ancient Appia Archaeological Park is a very young institution. We were actually started our activities back in 2017, aiming at the protection of an ancient and very important heritage asset, such as the Queen of the Roads, of the Roman Roads, Via Appia, built back in 312 before Christ. It was actually the Roman road connecting Rome with the Mediterranean basin, so a road which can have a very important role in our school, international school. The park is located between the city center of Rome and the Castelli Romani Hills to the south, including the territory of three different municipalities and a vast variety that you can see in this picture here of heritage assets, going from single monuments to archaeological sites and landscapes. Our park was involved last year, as my friend was saying before, in the program. We were very glad to, and we will be very glad to participate for the next one. Last year, two of our officers were involved, two architects, Luigi Oliva and Raffaella Rocchetta, were positively engaged in a challenging tutoring activity with our friends from Morocco and Palestine. The aim was to identify possible reference to Italian conservation laws that can be transferred to their own national legal frameworks. And I'm very, very glad to know that this experience has led to some important achievements in public institutions by our international scholars when they return to their countries. So we want definitely to follow on this activity. This year, we have six officers that will be available for the new program. We have these officers include archaeologists, architects, and conservation experts. We can be included definitely in the short-term activity of online webinar courses and lessons, which is, as someone was saying before, the possible activity during the pandemic period. And some of the teams we can, officers can teach, they have language and teaching skills, so they are available for different themes, such as all periods, really archaeology, with a specific focus on population and religion, survey methods and interdisciplinary approaches in archaeological excavation, archaeology of architecture and trade with a specific focus on methods and some case studies in northern Italy, principles of restoration for decorated surfaces in Italy, then restoration, research and enhancement of architectural, archaeological and landscape assets, and finally conservation projects, maintenance of monuments and protection of sites within an archaeological park as we are. So this is our availability for the short-term activity of organizing online webinar courses and lessons. We are also totally available with our six officers to the medium and long-term possible activities aiming at the development of these twinnings with our international partners. And we are available to both activities, the expert missions for identifying training needs and packages for conservation and heritage management staff, and training activities such as thematic workshops abroad and internships here in Rome, as we did last year. According to the following fields, the different things can be in conservation and research. We can go from collaboration with university students in the field of architecture, landscape and urban planning, a specific focus, and this is something I really would like to work on, is implementation of cultural routes. We being actually a cultural route, together as being an ancient Roman road, and it's a field we can give really some basic information, some important information. Then we go from the research analysis, maintenance and restoration for archaeological sites, as we are, and a focus on current Italian legislation, as we did last year, and an exchange of know-how on traditional construction and restoration techniques. We can also apply to two different themes in heritage management, including platforms for an inclusive governance of parks and definition of a knowledge and maintenance plans, plan for the control and monitoring of sites belonging to the park. Going to the last possible long-term theme, I definitely agree with most of you when you were talking about inclusiveness, which is one of the most important goals public administration should have, especially now here when the Convention of Faro was finally approved. And so definitely participation processes and involvement of local population in heritage and archaeological park management is of paramount importance. And I would add also not only, I would say local population, which include also people coming from abroad. We have single persons coming from different nations. Also, they can be organized in local communities of people coming from abroad. And this, for example, our park being sort of peripheral park is definitely important for this aspect of inclusiveness of also not only local people, but people coming from abroad and living in the area. Then training of local workers on tools, materials, and techniques for conservation of surfaces and structures, design for the improvement of accessibility, which is also another important field we are working on in this specific period, and development of educational games and for the dissemination of historical, artistic, and cultural assets. So this is our availability for next year program. Thank you very much.
Ringrazio moltissimo il direttore, soprattutto per essersi applicato con grande diligenza alle nostre richieste. Come vedete siamo molto già in fase avanzata, naturalmente il programma di attività andrà costruito tutti insieme, per il 2021 inizieremo con dei temi e naturalmente volevo ricordare che questo evento è registrato e verrà distribuito a tutti i partecipanti in modalità video. Quindi passerei immediatamente al CNR. Il CNR è la più importante istituzione pubblica italiana di ricerca. Nell'ambito del CNR c'è un istituto che si chiama Istituto per le Scienze e il Patrimonio Culturale, che è diretto da Costanza Miliani, alla quale buongiorno Costanza, do il benvenuto. Al CNR, nell'istituto diretto dalla dottoressa Miliani, ha lavorato Rita Licia, che è la partecipante dal Libano. Si è occupata di nuove tecnologie, realtà virtuale, realtà aumentata applicata ai beni culturali, e quindi passo la parola a Costanza Miliani. Grazie.
Good morning everybody. I'm going to spend my 5 minutes to give you an overview of what the Institute of Heritage Science is doing, with the perspective of underlying our willingness to participate to the follow-up of this very interesting program, and with our willingness of doing twinnings and international cooperation. So the Institute of Heritage Science has the mission to foster innovation in the field of cultural heritage through heritage science. That is a new umbrella, is a new field of application for cultural heritage, where we draw on diverse type of science, starting from the humanities, social science, experimental science, formal science, and engineering, always to enhance and the understanding, care, and sustainable use of our heritage. So the Institute has about 130 researchers with a strong attitude to the interdisciplinary research and a strong attitude to international cooperation, as we will see in a minute. We have about 9 laboratories and 7 locations for these laboratories and research. Regarding the laboratories, our net network is absolutely open to co-creation idea and open to collaboration and involvement of the stakeholder from the time zero. So when we start thinking to a research, we really want together on the same table, different disciplines, but also the stakeholders that are really nearby the cultural heritage. The laboratories are ranging and are organized in three different families. Mobile laboratories, so all what is regarding the use of non-invasive and portable method to study heritage and the conservation state and all what is regarding material and structure. We are ranging from very close examination to very long examination as satellite image or remote sensing through drone. Then we have also, I would like to mention, a digital activity, and there is a virtual heritage lab located in Rome and Lecce. And exactly in the virtual heritage lab in Rome, Rita Lacea from Lebanon had her experience in Italy, and we were also very glad for having her in our labs, and was a really win-win interaction. The Virtual Heritage Lab is devoted to development of new virtual reality, enhanced reality, digital storytelling, gamings for the valorization and understanding of heritage. We have also a heritage building information modeling lab, and finally, a laboratory that is devoted to open access and open knowledge, and all these we have understood and has been already mentioned how is important in this terrible period of COVID, where really we have to be engaged in a sharing of knowledge and learning to collaborate from distance. Also, all this activity is part of a European adventure that is a MOLA platform where we are coordinating also different type of mobile instrument to study the object, heritage object on site. So we are moving this high advanced methodology directly in museum, in archaeological site, or in conservation studios from Italy to other countries. And this is part of the European Research Infrastructure for Heritage Science that Italy and CNR is leading. And this is opening a great opportunity for all the researchers in Europe, but also outside Europe, to be able to be involved and use advanced technology for heritage. The Institute is devoted to research activity in this through big area, that is knowledge, conservation, and valorization, always using an interdisciplinary approach, so working together with between humanities and STEM. And also, we are very prone to international collaboration, and here I'm reporting just as an example, different type of project that has been funded by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and are all regarding archaeological research that are in different Mediterranean countries. Finally, I would like to mention also for our future cooperation, this European project BIP, that is about the within the call of cross-border cooperation in the Mediterranean, and is about the application of BIM information technology for energy efficiency of building in the public sector, but with a special focus also on heritage building. The cooperation is between Italy, Spain, Cyprus, Jordan, Palestine, Lebanon, and Egypt. And so I think it's a good example of what we can do together, because it's about interdisciplinarity, intersectorial study, the Green Deal, the Heritage and International Cooperation. So I hope we can further increase our connection together through the Fondazione Scuola Beni Attività Culturali. So thank you.
Molte grazie a Costanza Miliani. Andrei direttamente a questo punto all'ultimo intervento, che è quello della Fondazione Brescia Musei. A Brescia ha fatto l'internship Husam Eddin Al-Khatib dalla Palestina e si è occupato di un oggetto molto importante, che è un oggetto di carta, che è il piano di gestione UNESCO. E in questa sede abbiamo la presidente della fondazione, l'avvocato Francesca Bazzoli. Buongiorno avvocato. Saluto lei, saluto il direttore Stefano Karachov, che è sicuramente da qualche parte lì con voi, e ci racconterà di una importantissima operazione di comunicazione e coinvolgimento della cittadinanza costruita intorno a un momento molto importante per Brescia, che è stato il ritorno in città di un simbolico monumento cittadino. Prego, avvocato.
Thank you very much for inviting me. Today I would like to talk to you on how it is possible to preserve the archaeological heritage and turn it into an example of cultural and social development, as we have done with the project of the Winged Victory. Brescia is a city located a few kilometers east of Milan. It has a long-lasting roots in the Roman time. Here, a moment, here you can see, potete mandare avanti le immagini. Here you can see the Capitolium, the Roman temple of the first century AD, where in the Eastern Hall is now located the extraordinary statue of the Winged Victory. I hope you can see it. In addition to the archaeological Roman site, we manage as Foundation Brescia Musei, the Museum of Santa Giulia, located in an ancient Longobard monastery, the Museum of Arms and Weapons, as well as the Pinacoteca Tosio Martinengo, our art gallery with painting from the Renaissance to the 19th century. Since 2011, the Monastery of Santa Giulia and the archaeological Roman area are inscribed in the UNESCO World Heritage List as part of Longobards in Italy, Landmarks of Power, the serious site that includes all the Italian cities where Longobards established their major dukedoms. Our institutional goals are the protection, conservation, enhancement, study and research of the cultural heritage in order to develop promotional and cultural activities and maintain the legacy for the future generations. We want to address cultural projects in order to launch our city as an example, not only in restoration and conservation, but also in valorization. Thanks to our skills and teamwork, we are a good example of best practice in keeping alive the connection between Brescia, cultural history, and its future as a city of art. The Winged Victory is one of the most important Roman bronze in the world, found in the archaeological area of Brescia in 1826. We have focused on this statue in the last 2 years for a stunning restoration project that has become the starting point of a wider project dedicated to the cultural enhancement of the entire city. Here you can see the results of the cleaning of surfaces before and after the restorations. Thanks to this project, we have moved to the Winged Victory from the Museum of Santa Giulia to Capitolium, the place of its discovery, in a new layout designed by the Spanish artist Juan Navarro Valdebec. Starting from the restoration project, we have developed an artistic program entirely dedicated to the Winged Victory, with exhibition, performances, permanent project, and publications. The first important event of the program was the opening in September 2020 of a monographic exhibition dedicated to Juan Navarro Valdebec and his artistic languages in Santa Giulia Museum. We recently opened a monumental installation known as the Incalcellabile Vittoria, designed by contemporary Italian artist Emilio Sgro, and permanently exposed in the subway of Brescia, access point to the city, in order to spread the meaning of the Winged Victory project to the city, breaking up the immaterial wall that normally museums built up around their collections. As you can see, the Winged Victory project became also a visual identity project that conveys our communication for the 2020 and the 2021. Here, in a moment, here is the cultural program, as I have already said, with many events that can help the city to depart from its tradition to be an industrial pole to become a big cultural heritage center. We also used all the good means of the contemporary communication and cultural industries. We realized a new original comic dedicated to the Winged Victory, together with the Italian Mickey Mouse magazine. We also realized, with the collaboration of Poste Italiane, an original stamp, which is now distributed to Italy. Thanks for your attention. I hope my speech explained the way we can turn an important Roman bronze in a complex model of contemporary valorization. And I give my support to share the know-how we have developed to all the partners of the International School of Cultural Heritage. This is our positive answer to the question Mr. Trione asked at the beginning of this event.
Grazie, grazie molto a Francesca Bazzoli. Grazie molte davvero per la vostra disponibilità e per il vostro importante lavoro. A questo punto, con 7-8 minuti di ritardo, dei quali mi ritengo personalmente particolarmente soddisfatto, introdurrei il signor Ministro. Buongiorno signor Ministro, benvenuto. La ringraziamo molto per questa partecipazione, per noi è un segnale naturalmente molto importante, anche perché ricordo che lei era presente il 6 novembre dell'anno scorso, il giorno dell'inaugurazione. Mi prendo il compito di portarle i saluti della nostra fondazione, del presidente Trione, della direttrice Alessandra Vittorini e dell'ambasciatore Meloni. Dicevo, la sua presenza è molto importante, per noi è un incoraggiamento fortissimo e anche una forte responsabilizzazione. Se lei è d'accordo, signor Ministro, manderei 2 minuti di video che riassumono quello che è successo in questo importante progetto e poi le do la parola. Quindi ho visto un sì e chiederei alla regia di partire.
In a very short period of time, we got to see almost everything about cultural heritage in Italy, and it's been great.
I enjoyed very much all the formative offer, which was very wide and brought over from top-level professionals of the sectors.
La cosa più importante che ho avuto come esperienza tramite questa bellissima fondazione dei beni e attività culturale, diffondere la capevolezza dell'importanza di un patrimonio culturale e come mantenerlo bene.
I would like to thank the International School of Cultural Heritage for giving us this great opportunity which we will never ever forget in our life.
Prego, signor Ministro, a lei la parola.
Grazie a voi, davvero il video dà senso dell'importanza e della bellezza di questo progetto. E io vorrei ringraziare tutti la governance del Presidente, della direttrice, tutti quelli che hanno lavorato e stanno lavorando all'idea della scuola, della Fondazione Scuola Beni Culturali, Beni Attività Culturali, anche quelli che hanno lavorato al progetto in precedenza. È un'idea nata non troppo tempo fa. Normalmente un'idea di cui si è discusso moltissimo la Scuola del Patrimonio, ma poi mai partita. E non è partita non molto tempo fa. Normalmente tra un'idea e la sua concreta realizzazione passa molto tempo. In realtà in questo caso è andato tutto molto veloce e molto bene. E quindi sono davvero orgoglioso di questo lavoro che ha una molteplicità di funzioni. Abbiamo visto anche dagli interventi precedenti quanto trasferimento di know-how ci possa essere in una scuola che fa formazione, ma che contemporaneamente davvero mette in condizione di avere uno scambio reciproco di esperienze, che è importante sempre, ma è importante in particolare nel settore della tutela, della valorizzazione del patrimonio culturale, un campo su cui l'Italia esercita e può esercitare, naturalmente insieme ad altri paesi, un ruolo di leadership. Per questo dall'inizio l'idea della scuola è stata finalizzata in due campi, un campo diciamo interno italiano che si svilupperà sempre di più per non accavallarsi in nessun modo ai normali percorsi formativi, sino alla fine dei percorsi formativi universitari o di specializzazione, ma consentire di avere un luogo in cui si trasformano le formazioni universitarie, scolastiche, universitarie di base in una specializzazione finalizzata, quindi specializzare persone adatte a fare i soprintendenti, quindi dedicate alla tutela, persone dedicate alla valorizzazione o alla direzione dei musei. È una cosa molto importante, per cui abbiamo anche introdotto recentemente una norma nuova nel nostro ordinamento che consentirà anche di dare uno sbocco, certo, attraverso la forma del corso concorso, che non si è mai stata nel settore dei beni culturali, e io interpreto questa soltanto come una prima tappa. La seconda parte di attività della scuola, quella che abbiamo visto oggi, è la parte internazionale. Questa idea è nata qualche anno fa perché noi abbiamo sempre offerto come paese dei luoghi, penso ai nostri istituti di ricerca, l'ICR, l'Opificio delle Pietre Dure ed altri, dei luoghi di formazione, offerta di formazione anche a ospiti che vengono da altri paesi. Abbiamo pensato di mettere a sistema questo percorso offrendo una scuola internazionale, una parte della scuola che sia internazionale, che sia dedicata allo scambio di conoscenze, alla formazione di professionalità specifiche, per mettere a frutto in qualche modo quel know-how che in Italia è molto antico, è molto radicato, è molto importante. Quindi abbiamo visto anche dai partecipanti a questo corso e della qualità delle relazioni, delle lezioni, davvero come si possa puntare non soltanto a trasferire know-how, ma anche, consentitemi di dirlo, a formare delle classi dirigenti, per usare un termine che forse è inappropriato, ma rende l'idea, delle classi dirigenti che si occupano nei loro paesi di cultura, di tutela e valorizzazione del patrimonio culturale, che restano legate tra loro, perché quando si frequenta una scuola ci si conosce, ci si ascolta, ci si integra e poi si porta dietro per tutta la vita quell'esperienza. Ed è veramente molto importante che noi come Italia diamo un contributo a avere persone che si occuperanno di cultura e di gestione del patrimonio culturale nei loro paesi, legati da un'esperienza comune come può essere la frequentazione di una scuola. Quindi dal mio punto di vista siamo solo all'inizio. La scuola crescerà, la doteremo di una sede importante e prestigiosa, crescerà come mezzi e risorse, perché dovrà ampliare tutte queste attività. Quindi davvero alla direttrice, al presidente, spetta una grande sfida, che in questo mandato deve essere il salto di qualità, potendo avere alle spalle tutto quello che noi abbiamo: l'esperienza dei musei, l'esperienza degli istituti di ricerca, l'esperienza delle soprintendenze. Guardate, un'altra delle sfide del futuro, che passerà non solo ma anche attraverso la scuola della Fondazione Scuola Beni e Attività Culturali è realizzare nel campo della cultura quello che si è realizzato nel campo della sanità. Provo a spiegarmi meglio. Noi abbiamo da anni integrato tra loro l'esperienza universitaria, le facoltà di medicina e chirurgia, con l'esperienza degli ospedali policlinici. E sono moltissime le città italiane in cui l'integrazione tra università e ospedale consente di dare agli ospedali la possibilità di avere giovani che fanno ricerca, che innovano, che portano entusiasmo ed innovazione. Dall'altro, all'università, di offrire ai propri studenti o specializzandi la possibilità di sperimentare sul campo. Ecco, noi in Italia abbiamo molte facoltà universitarie che si occupano di beni e attività culturali, di cultura, e abbiamo le soprintendenze radicate territorialmente in tutto il territorio, o i musei. Capite bene l'integrazione, perché questo dicevo sul modello sanitario, di queste due esperienze, che enorme possibilità di formazione, di ricerca, di innovazione può offrire. Quindi insomma abbiamo molte cose da fare, io vi ringrazio per le cose di oggi e per il lavoro che avete fatto e vi aspetta molto più lavoro e molto più sfide nel futuro, quindi saremo qui a sostenervi ma a chiamarvi anche a rispettare questi obiettivi ambiziosi.
Molte grazie signor Ministro, davvero. A questo punto direi che possiamo, senza che io sottolinei nulla di questo intervento, se non che la Fondazione crescerà, passerei alla terza sessione di lavoro che è coordinata da Munir Bouchnaki, che naturalmente non ha bisogno di alcuna presentazione. Munir Bouchnaki ci guiderà in questo dialogo con i rappresentanti dei ministeri dei paesi invitati. E quindi abbiamo anche l'ospite turco, dottor Bouchnaki, non so se ha avuto notizia, quindi abbiamo il completo, siamo al completo. Gli passo indegnamente il testimone e riprenderò la parola a conclusione di questa sessione che contiamo termini intorno all'1:30. Grazie.
Grazie mille, buonasera a tutti. Excellencies, Excellency Ministro della Cultura Italiana, Excellencies, all experts who presented very in detail the experience of their laboratories, of their sites, of their museums. And I am really pleased and honored to participate in this session of the International School of Cultural Heritage with my colleagues and friends. I see so many colleagues in the list, which is before me, who participated to this very, very unique experience. An experience, as the minister said, which is bringing knowledge, scientific approach, work and training in situ, and as it was also said in the beginning of this session, it is bringing collaboration and cooperation for the cultural heritage of the Mediterranean area and also beyond, beyond the Mediterranean area, since we have also a colleague from Ethiopia. In order to respect the timing, I will not say more, and then I want to invite the first speaker is my friend, Dr. Toufik Hamoum, former director of the CNR, Centre National de Recherche Archéologique, and from in the Ministry of Culture, and also professor at Algiers University. Toufik Hamoum, you have the floor to explain how you have, in few minutes, took experience and make also evaluation of what has been done during your stay in Italy. Toufik, you have the floor. Go ahead.
Shukran, Ustad Munir. Shukran li ma'ali al-wazir alladhi sharafana bi mudakhalatihi al-qayyima. Awad qabla kulli shay an ashkur al-qa'imin ala al-madrasa al-dawliya li التراث الثقافي بإيطاليا على دعوتي للمشاركة في هذا النقاش في بمناسبة تخرج الدفعة الأولى أو الدورة الأولى التكوينية في مجال التراث الثقافي لدول بحر الأبيض المتوسط. في الحقيقة أود فقط الإشارة أنه في قائمة المتربصين لاحظت أن الجزائر غائبة في قائمة المتربصين وهذا يؤسفني جدا. فيما يخص التقييم الأولي حسب المداخلات أو مداخلة الزملاء في هذه الصبيحة يعني التقييم هو جد إيجابي نظرا لطراء التكوين ومضمون المداخلات التي تضمنت في التكوين في هذا المجال في الحفاظ وتثمين التراث الثقافي في إيطاليا بالخصوص وفي دول البحر الأبيض المتوسط بصفة عامة. فمن خلال التتبع لكل هذه المداخلات فهي عملية جد هامة تهم كل دول البحر الأبيض المتوسط لأن التراث الثقافي هو متقاسم بشكل مباشر بين كل الدول فهو تراث نتقاسمه جميعا في محتوياته وفي أشكاله المختلفة. فأهمية التكوين هو مهم جدا بالنسبة لكل الدول لأن من ناحية العملية الحفاظ والتثمين والترميم هي عملية مشتركة نتقاسمها كل المختصين يتقاسمون نفس الأفكار ونفس النظريات. فقضية التكوين مهمة جدا خاصة لبلدان الضفة الجنوبية للبحر الأبيض المتوسط. فعملية التكوين مهمة جدا خاصة في إعادة رسكلة الخبراء العاملين في القطاعات في قطاع حماية التراث وتثمين التراث فهذا مهم جدا لنا. فنود في المستقبل أن نتعامل بشكل مباشر لتحديد المواضيع أو المضامين التي يمكن الاستفادة منها فيما يخص عملية الترميم والحفاظ والترويج أيضا وتسيير كل التراث الثقافي بكل أشكاله وبكل أشكاله المختلفة. فهذا مهم بالنسبة لدول الضفة الغربية الجنوبية عفوا لدول البحر الأبيض المتوسط. فأنا سعيد جدا بتواجدي في بينكم لتقاسم كل هذه الآراء وكل هذه الخبرة القيمة من قبل الخبراء الموجودين أمامنا. فنحن ننتظر مستقبلا إن أردتم التعاون يعني فتح مجال التعاون والتكوين بشكل فعال ومباشر. فأشكركم جزيل الشكر على دعوتي وتقاسمي معكم هذه الأفكار وهذه الآراء. فالجزائر مستعدة بشكل مباشر للتعاون والتبادل في مجال الخبرات والتكوين في مجال التراث الثقافي. شكرا أستاذ منير على الدعوة وعلى هذا الترحيب وإليكم الكلمة وشكرا جزيلا لكل القائمين على هذه الدورة وأملنا أن الجزائر ستشارك في الدورة المقبلة إن شاء الله وشكرا.
شكرا جزيلا الأخ العزيز توفيق حموم على هذا التدخل. I want to say that our colleague from Algeria, you know, expressed his satisfaction about this important event and this important training, and he is offering, of course, the collaboration of Algeria in this field. In order not to waste time, I want to give the floor now to our colleague, Director General of Central Administration for Public and International Relations in the Ministry of Antiquities of Egypt, Dr. Abdel Mohsen Saeed Shafi. Doctor, you have the floor.
Hello, everybody. Mr. Minister Franceschini, Madam Vittorini, Excellency Ambassador Serini, Mr. Ramirez, distinguished participants and colleagues. First of all, I would like to stress the strength of the Egyptian-Italian relations in all aspects and fields, including the cultural heritage preservation and conservation. The Egyptian linkage to the Mediterranean region, a cradle of civilization and cradle of peace and coexistence. I would like to express our gratitude and appreciation towards the efforts of the foundation and receiving our experts who participated in the program. I would like to be very brief in my comments, only very positive feedback about the program, about how useful it was for our experts. The evaluation in general is very positive, and we are looking forward for the coming rounds of exchanges for the benefit of our parties, our countries in the region. I made a very short list on the areas where we would like to develop more communication and to have them more present in the coming trainings and programs that I would like to share with you all. The management of museums and heritage sites, the management part itself is very important, I guess, for us and for our experts to get more knowledge and to exchange ideas on the best practices on preservation and conservation for sure, communication strategies and methods of involving the local communities, reaching the point of raising their awareness about the heritage sites they live beside and the heritage in general is very important. And we would like to begin some initiatives on this, on our heritage sites, different ones in Egyptian regions. Income generation, digitalization and virtual realities technologies are also of a great importance in the coming period of time. Something that was raised because of the pandemic that we are facing now and the time we have lived through. A final comment I would like to speak about that in Egypt, we have merged ministries of tourism and antiquities in one ministry. This is like for 1 year now, and we believe this is a good opportunity to speak about the sustainability of the preservation, plus also alleviating the pressure on the heritage sites that comes from tourism. So this is a good opportunity, and we are ready also to share our experience on this and to get more knowledge from our colleagues on similar ideas of administration. I thank you very much, and I'm really looking forward for to working with you, with the foundation, and your distinguished governments and authorities. Thank you all.
For your very important intervention, and all of us, we know how much Egypt is rich in terms of cultural heritage. I've had the chance to work for a long time with your administration and all director generals of the High Council of Antiquities. I participated to the inauguration of the Museum of Nubia in Aswan. I followed the creation of the new Museum of Egyptian Civilization in Cairo, and we followed the progress of work for the GEM, the Grand Egyptian Museum. And I think that you insisted rightly in the field of management of museums and to have this exchange between the Italian experts and the Egyptian experts in this field, but also you listed a number of very important issues that could be the subject for future training in Egypt and in Italy. Thank you so much for your intervention. Now we move to a colleague from Ethiopia, Mr. Feseha Mulugeta, General Director in the Authority for Research and Conservation of Cultural Heritage, Ministry of Culture and Tourism, Ethiopia. You have, sir, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman, Excellencies, Ministers, Honorables, ladies and gentlemen. First, I would like to say that I'm very honored to be part of this very important and timely workshop. And I would like to thank you for your relentless effort in organizing and materializing today's workshop among all these difficult and testing times. I also would like to say that I have gathered feedbacks from the Ethiopian trainees who attended this the last year's training, and they were very happy, and all the trainings were super, and they are all thankful. I want to convey that to you. I am really impressed by all the presentations that I heard of today. They are all super in terms of content and organization. And I would like to say that thanking for all the offers given to the Ethiopian trainees and trainees for people from all over in the world. And we would like to continue our collaboration in a much better and organized way. And having said this, I have seen previously also from the documents sent to me and from the participants who attended the training and from today's presentation, it's very inclusive and complete, but I would like to add a bit on future training content if possible. And probably this could be from me as I am coming from Ethiopia, where more than 80% of the population are agrarian. So trainings for the future participants, if it's possible, and if it has to include on community empowerment, meaning to include the community in the destinations where the heritages are found, would be very important. And many times when we talk about community empowerment, it's a very short time, you know, trainings and kind of awareness creation that's going on. But what I'm saying is to be really very inclusive in terms of looking at the existing knowledge of society about heritage and heritage resources, trying to find out the gaps that they have if they have to be part of the development process and beneficiary from the heritage development, and also some capacity building measures to enable them to be truly part of the heritage development and also to be beneficiaries. So these trainees who would be participating in the future training programs will have a knowledge and know-how on how to train a community on heritage resources, on some preliminary heritage conservation and preservation, and on-site development. With this, it will make the heritage site development more complete and also inclusive of the society. Having said this, I wanted to again to say thank you for all that you are contributing and for all the presenters and for the initiative, and full-heartedly we'll be very happy to collaborate for future collaborations at all magnitudes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Director General, for your intervention, and thank you for bringing the experience of Ethiopia where I had the honor also to accompany the Pope Abuna Paulos to La Libela and Axum a few years ago, and to participate to the return of the Stela of Axum. And I have seen how much the population, I have very dramatic pictures, how much the population either in La Libela or in Axum was interested in the preservation of the rock churches in La Libela and in the Axum capital. So your intervention are, you know, pointing out two points, you know. One is community participation, and I know from my colleagues of the International School that this is one of the topics that will be also pursued, because it is one of the recommendations of UNESCO as well. The second point is the view of the training which is done at this level, at the high level training, which is in fact a way to prepare training for trainers, you know, that is the way to disseminate the knowledge that people can get at this professional level in Italy, and to have it also dispatched and disseminated in the country. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The next speaker is a colleague, Professor Laith Majid Hussain, Director of the State Board of Antiquities and Heritage in the Ministry of Culture of Iraq. Professor and dear friend, you have the floor.
شكرا جزيلا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إنه لفخر كبير أن يعقد هذا التجمع وسط أجواء وتحديات استثنائية. وهذا فإن دل على شيء فإنما يدل على حرص القائمين عليه على ديمومة التواصل العلمي والمعرفي البناء والذي كان هدفنا الرئيسي في المحافل والتجمعات الدولية. لقد غدا الحفاظ على الموروث الحضاري أيها الحضور الكرام مفصلا مهما وعنوانا صعبا في شجرة علم الآثار الحديث. فلم يعد علم الآثار مجرد مخزنا محصنا للمقتنيات فحسب، أن من طلق في الأفق الواسع ليغدو منبرا تعليميا تثقيفيا لديه رسالة بعيدة المدى والمعاني والأهداف، وأصبحت كل قطعة فيه تروي لنا حدثا تاريخيا وطمط اللثام عن معلومة كانت مبهمة أو منسية. إن علم الآثار اليوم ينطلق لآفاق واسعة ورحبة في ظل التطور العلمي والتقني الذي يتم تسخيره بشكل صحيح في خدمة العرض الآثاري. فقد أضحى علم الآثار اليوم بوابات تعليمية حقيقية لتنشئة الأجيال من خلال تسليط الضوء على تاريخ بلدهم، لزيادة الوعي والإدراك والحفاظ على تراث هذا البلد. إننا اليوم بحاجة لتوعية شاملة لهذا الجيل لكي يحافظ على تراث بلده، لأنها عنصر من عناصر مقومات النجاح والسير به على الطريق القويم من خلال محاربته للتجارة بالآثار والسرقة والنبش العشوائي للمواقع، لأنها عناصر تحطيم وتدمير لمقدرات هذا البلد والتراث العالمي. إننا اليوم في مجال الآثار أمام تحدي كبير وخطير من أجل وقف النزيف المستمر منذ سنين لاستهداف حضارة وآثار هذا البلد العريق. فقد أصبح الاتجار بالآثار العراقية اليوم ديداً ضعاف النفوس في الداخل والخارج، ولكننا عازمون وماضون في القضاء على هذه الآفة. إننا نقدم شكرنا وتقديرنا لجميع المنظمات والمؤسسات الدولية التي هبت وأبدت روح المساعدة بأقصى سرعة لصيانة الموروث العراقي الذي دمره الدواعش أعداء الإنسانية، وهم مستمرون في مد يد العوم لترميم ما دمره العدوان الغاشم. إننا اليوم بحاجة ماسة لتدريب طواقمنا الآثارية من خلال مشاركتهم بدورات الصيانة والترميم في المؤسسات التخصصية لاستحصال المعرفة الحديثة لديمومة التواصل المعرفي والاستزازة من العلوم الحديثة. هناك الآن العديد من مشاريع الصيانة والترميم في أكثر المناطق تضرراً بهجمة داعش الإرهابية، ألا وهي مدينة الموصل القديمة والمسجد النوري والبوابات والقصور الآشورية، حيث أصابها الكثير من التدمير والسلب والنهب لطمس معالم هذه الآثار الشاخصة والشامخة في وجه الظلامية. كذلك الحال فيما يخص بعض المواقع التي أصابها الضرر بسبب عوامل المناخ أو الصيانة السيئة لها، أدى بها إلى أن تتساقط وتتداعى وكان أفضل مثال حول ذلك تساقط أجزاء من طاق كسرى تايسفون بسبب عوامل التعرية والظروف البيئية المحيطة وسارعنا بالاستعانة بمنظمة ألف حيث أرسلت إلى بغداد بشكل عاجل فريق عمل تخصصي لتقييم الأضرار لتلافي استمرار التساقط وإيجاد السبل لصيانة وترميم الطاق ونحن شاكرون جداً لهذه السرعة في الاستجابة أخيراً نحن شاكرون ونشكركم جداً من صميم أعماقنا لجهودكم ودعمكم المستمر وأيضاً لتفانيكم في نصرة رسالة العراق في صيانة آثاره وإنقاذ تراثه العالمي شكراً جزيلاً
شكراً جزيلاً دكتور ليث على هذا التدخل القيم. I want to express my really sincere thanks about your intervention because as you know your country and you have said it very clearly suffered from so many damages by Daesh and I have seen personally how Mosul has been nearly totally destroyed and fortunately now I think you are bringing also a vision of hope in the international cooperation. You have mentioned ALIF. I am a member of the scientific committee of ALIF and I know how much things can be done actually in Mosul, in Baghdad, but also in Ctesiphon. You have raised also a point which is very important, the raising of awareness among the population, which is, you know, a link with what was done also, was said also by our precedent orator, precedent intervenant about the raising the awareness. I think this is a topic that also could be part of the programs in the future by the international school. And also the question of the illicit traffic of cultural property that your country suffered so much. Thank you again for your intervention. Now we move to Mr. John Seligman, Director of External Relations and Archaeological Licensing at the Israel Antiquities Authority. John is also a colleague whom I know for so many years during the missions we undertook as UNESCO in Jerusalem. And I am pleased to give him the floor to intervene in this very important statement made by high-level authorities in the field of cultural heritage. John, you have the floor.
thank you very much. Thank you to the International School of Cultural Heritage, to the director, Alessandra Vittorini. I thank also the intervention of the Dario Franceschini. And of course, it's great to see you when you after so many years of your work in Jerusalem on our past ventures, and personally, when I was on the course at ICROM almost 20 years ago. So seeing you again, of course, is always fantastic. You don't age, but I do, but that's the way it works. Anyhow, we'd like to see how we continue to advance the cause of cultural heritage, which we've done so many years, and that continued vitality is very, very important to us. First of all, I'd like to say, I don't want to repeat what other people have said already, there's really not much point. First of all, of course, we greatly welcome this course. We deeply encourage this kind of international cooperation, and this sort of kind of transcultural involvement is something that we see is very important for our societies, as the mutual professional interests that we all have greatly outweigh any sort of divisions which exist within the region. So this is something which we see as of great importance. Of course, none of us have a monopoly on knowledge. We all learn from each other, and I think one of the great importance is that we can step outside preconceived national paradigms and open our minds to new ways of thinking, which happen on a dual level. Firstly, through the instruction from the very important institutions which are involved in the course, but also from the interconnection between the various participants in the course, which also show them how the ways that different countries deal with so many of these issues. I'd like to divide my comments into two parts. Of course, the comments which I gleaned from our participant, Julia Rocobella, who had to cut short her course because she gave birth to a baby girl shortly after the course, to which we say in Hebrew, Mazal Tov, and which means congratulations. That means that she wasn't able to participate in the second part of the course. But certainly one of the major issues that she raised in our discussions was of the importance and of the great level of instruction which they received during the instruction, the kind of contacts and the contacts and also the exposure to centers of knowledge, especially in Italy, but also around the Mediterranean basement, which was very important. That, of course, she has passed on to other employees inside the Israel Antiquities Authority, and that is something which is very useful because the dissemination is not only to the people in the course itself, but it goes beyond that to people who are come into contact with those people when they return home. A number of subjects which we were very important were the issues of risk assessment, which was a central part of the course, as far as I understand. This creates something which requires much more in-depth discussion. You know, many of us as humans wait until the situation in a tectonic region like the Mediterranean is too late. So dealing with these issues is very, very important. And the inter-regional consultation is just as important as the contact again with the local authorities inside Italy. The importance of economic management of cultural heritage is an important issue. As it's practiced, it creates clear policy management and legal regulation, which then goes on to best practice within the various nations that are dealing with it. We were very impressed with the emphasis on the digital applications in cultural heritage. That was also shown through some of the work we were shown a little bit earlier. This, of course, is a research tool used through digital analysis, which is a common across many, many of our institutions and is the way forward. And this is the way that we can, on the one hand, improve our own research, but also provide public accessibility to cultural heritage through digital tools. I would like to add also that the concentration only on the southern and eastern sides of the Mediterranean is maybe something which can be improved on. We think that encouraging also participation of other countries around the Mediterranean basin would be something which would be beneficial to all the partners within this course. So those are the few comments we have on the course itself. And I think there were two major issues which you've asked us in the paper which you sent to us prior to the seminar. And one of them, of course, was the use of webinars. Of course, webinars have become incredibly popular over the last few months since we're all stuck in our homes. We have all been seeing both the positive aspects and also the negative aspects of webinars. The lack of human contact, of course, is the major negative part of these webinars. We all see each other from this height upwards. We seem to have no legs any longer. So this is something which it's a negative aspect in the way that the human contact of even small talk is such an important part of the way that we interact with people, and that is completely lost through these webinars. And that's something which we have to take into account because it's actually is a central part of the courses. We have also, especially in the last 2-3 months, been attacked by a multiple list of webinars. We can mean webinars every day of the week, all day and every night. And that has become an issue that you've got to take into consideration. Many of them, of course, involve issues which are very similar to the International School of Cultural Heritage. Institutions such as ICROM, ICOMOS, EAC, European Archaeological Association, ASOR, World Heritage Committee, World Monuments Fund all have their own webinars. And we have to make sure that when you do want to do something like that, that you create a very defined niche that is actually being discussed. Courses, my wife is a teacher. I watch her with her school children every day, fighting them on teaching school through Zoom, has a good part again and a bad part. It requires good course material. Language becomes a very severe issue when you're talking about webinars. You have to deal with that. Certainly, it widens the circle and reduces the costs, but you've got to find a sort of balance in that, and I think that's an important thing to take into consideration. The twinning initiatives is something which was very important. We have something to learn from the Italian partners. We have something to learn from our Mediterranean partners. And with humility, maybe you also have something to learn from us. So I think that's an important part, important intervention which can be taken into account. We very much encourage that. And we encourage as soon as we come out of this COVID crisis, hopefully in 2022 at least, that we can actually return to coming back to Italy and return to coming to the institutions, and you can return to come to where we live to see how we can mutually provide mutual benefit. So thank you very much. Arrivederci, salam alaikum to everybody, and we hope to see you shortly in Rome.
Thank you. Thank you, John, for this intervention, which is, of course, mentioning the situation in which we are living, actually. It is true that we are moving from one webinar to another webinar. It is the solution that all institutions have found instead of being completely mute. But it's true that in our field, in the field of archaeology, in the field of historic monuments, in the field of museums, we cannot avoid the way of having direct contacts and to be in situ. Yesterday, I was speaking with my colleagues, Franca Miglioli, who was my colleague at UNESCO, and we were thinking that what is one of the benefits of this course in this international school is bringing colleagues, bringing professionals in situ, whether in Via Appia, whether in Pestum, or in the Egyptian Museum in Torino. This is the only way in our job to benefit from experience of the other. The second point is also when you have a group of scholars meeting together, there is not only the system of receiving information, acquiring experience, but also exchanging experience. And this is very important cross-cultural exchange that this school is going to provide. Fortunately, I will be more optimistic than you starting from 2021 and not waiting until 2022. Thank you so much for your intervention. Now, I want to give the floor to Mr. Yazid Elayan, Director General of the Department of Antiquities, Ministry of Tourism and Antiquities in Jordan. Al-Kalima lakum, Sayyidi.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, assalamu alaikum. Shukran li Mr. Munir. وتحية طيبة لمعالي وزير فرانشيسكيني والشكر الموصول طبعا للمدرسة الدولية للتراث على هذا التنظيم المتقن وهذه الدورة المفيدة. بصراحة نحن في الأردن سعداء بهذه العناوين التي طرحت في الدورة وسعداء جدا في موضوع التعاون في مجال حماية التراث وحماية الآثار. قد تختلف الشعوب خلال العصور القديمة على المياه والأراضي وعلى المصالح وعلى التجارة وعلى الطرق التجارية، ولكن بالنهاية تتوحد البشرية في موضوع حاليا في موضوع الهموم المشتركة مثل مقاومة الوباء، وتتوحد أيضا في موضوع حماية التراث، لأن التراث هو صفحة من صفحات كل شعب سواء في أوروبا أو في إفريقيا أو في آسيا أو في كل مكان. ولذلك أعتقد بأن الأمانة التي على كاهلنا هي أمانة كبيرة في موضوع التعاون للخروج بأفضل الممارسات القادرة على حماية التراث العالمي، لأنه ليس تراث مختص في دولة واحدة، ولكنه أمانة، هذا التراث أمانة عند كل دولة. طبعاً الأردن معروف أنه همزة الوصل بين كافة القارات، ولذلك على أرض الأردن أكثر من 100,000 موقع أثري، وجميعها من فجر التاريخ حتى اليوم لم ينقطع السكن فيها والاستيطان، ولذلك الأردن هو متحف مفتوح ويهمه دائما تبادل الخبرة في موضوع حماية هذا التراث الإنساني. طبعا المواضيع التي تطرحها هذه الدورة مواضيع تهمنا كثيرا نحن كدول يعني فقيرة نسبيا بالنسبة إلى حجم التراث الذي نمتلكه فحاليا نقوم بعملية التوثيق الإلكتروني لمواقعنا الأثرية وكانت الأردن سباقة في هذا المجال حاليا يوجد على قاعدة البيانات أكثر من 15,000 موقع أثري هي منتشرة على من شمال الأردن وجنوبها طبعا وما يزال أمامنا أكثر من 80,000 حتى نستطيع توثيقه ولدينا من القطع الأثرية آلاف مئات الألوف أيضا تحتاج إلى عملية حماية وتوثيق ولدينا متاحف منتشرة في المحافظات ولذلك فإن بناء القدرات للكوادر الفنية والكوادر الأثرية هي جزء لا يتجزأ من الاهتمام الاستراتيجي لكل دولة لأنه الآثار والتراث هو مثل حاجتنا إلى المياه وحاجتنا إلى الشرب وحاجتنا إلى الطعام لأنه هو يعني هو عنوان الإنسانية للمستقبل وللماضي وللحاضر ولذلك نحن شاكرين للمخرجات التي خرجت بها هذه الدورة ونتطلع إلى المزيد طبعاً النظريات التي يتعلمها الكوادر تحتاج أيضاً إلى ممارسات ميدانية وممارسات عملية قد نكون يعني شاكرين للدول الكبرى التي تدعم هذه الدورات طبعاً إيطاليا وحوض البحر الأبيض المتوسط من يحتوي على أقدم التاريخ الإنساني والأردن يحتوي على 7 أو 8 مدن من الديكابوليس الرومانية وهذا يدل على مدى التأثير الحضارات على المناطق الجغرافية وهناك تأثيرات عراقية في الأردن وهناك تأثيرات مصرية وهناك تأثيرات من كل وفارسية ولذلك هذا الإرث الحضاري يحتاج إلى بالإضافة إلى الخبرات المحلية يحتاج إلى خبرات دولية وإلى دعم من اليونسكو وإلى دعم من كل الهيئات وكل المدارس القادرة على تقديم المساعدة في حماية هذا الإرث ولذلك نحن نتطلع في الدول التي تحتاج إلى عون في حماية تراثها الكثير والعظيم والكبير إلى شيء عملي خاصة في موضوع الكوارث ولذلك احنا بالأردن نتطلع إلى 3 برامج رئيسية بالإضافة إلى كافة البرامج المطروحة والمسميات فعندنا دورة طرق تخزين اللغة الأثرية هي من أولويات العمل الأثري الذي يجب أن نطور هذه المهارات فيه بعد التهديدات التي تحصل من خلال الفقر المنتشر والذي ينتشر بسبب الجوائح مثل جائحة كورونا ولا نعلم في المستقبل كيف يمكن أن تدار الأمور من ناحية كارثية ولذلك يجب وضع نظريات ويجب وضع خطط عملية في موضوع تخزين وأرشفة القطع الأثرية بالإضافة إلى تقنيات رقمية نحتاج إلى طرق حديثة لحوسبة كافة المواقع والقطع الأثرية بالإضافة إلى دورات في إدارة وحفظ التراث الأثري في وقت الأزمات والكوارث وعملية إخلاء نحتاج إلى خطط وتدريبنا على عمليات الإخلاء لأنه متاحفنا ومستودعاتنا بالكاد تتسع للموروث الذي ورثناه فكيف فينا بإيجاد أماكن وطرق وخطط لعملية الإخلاء في حالة الكوارث ولذلك نتطلع إلى تطوير عمليات التعاون في عناوين تمس الفترات التي نمر بها من أحداث الدنيا تتغير وتغيرت كثيراً خلال العام الماضي بسبب هذا الفيروس فما بالك لو تغير المناخ أو لو تغير الاقتصاد أو لو تغيرت الصراع السياسي أو العسكري في بين الدول ولذلك التراث هو أول ما يهدد دائماً لأن التراث عبارة عن مال عبارة عن مخرج يمكن استخدامه كثروة ولذلك يجب حمايته كما يحمي المال وهذا تطلعنا في هذا الموضوع وشكرا بالنهاية لكافة المنظمين لهذه الدورة شكرا للمدرسة الدولية للتراث شكرا لإيطاليا وشكرا لليونسكو ولجميع المشاركين تحياتنا لهم على هذا الصبر وهذا النتائج والمخرجات الإيجابية التي ستكون إحدى لبنات حماية التراث في حوض البحر الأبيض المتوسط وفي كافة المناطق شكرا
شكرا جزيلا Thank you so much dear Director General for your intervention Jordan is a country where as soon as I started in UNESCO in 1982 I was in contact with one of your predecessors, Dr. Hadidi, for the restoration of the Ain Ghazal statuette, which was one of the most precious discovery. And we worked very closely with you and with the Department of Conservation in order to present them now very nicely in the Museum of Amman. As you said very rightly, there are diversity of situations but you insisted on one point which is important in the philosophy of the training courses. There is a unity of approach to the training aspects concerning the mapping, the surveying, capacity building in museums, in archaeological sites, and also in making prevention about different kind of risk. Risk which could be natural risk like earthquake, like climate change, like the present COVID, but also risk that can come from human beings. And I think these are topics that most probably our colleagues at the International School are taking note about in order to make a specific point, which was also said by the predecessor scholar about the risk assessment. And I think the philosophy that you have developed in a short message, but which was very strong, is that what we should be all together unite for heritage. If you remember, it was the logo of Mrs. Bokova when she was Director General of UNESCO, and when she went to the University of Baghdad, she launched this logo, and I think this is very important to make sure that whatever is our situations, different situations, different kind of heritage, what we should do is to be well-trained, well-prepared for the challenges which are facing cultural heritage. Thank you so much again for your intervention. The next speaker is Director General of Antiquities and Directorate General of Antiquities in Lebanon, my colleague and friend Sarkis El Khoury. Dr. Khoury, you are here. Masa Al Khair. Dr. Khoury, you have. Dr. Khoury, you have the floor.
Good morning. Dear Excellencies, dear colleagues, first of all, I would like to thank the Italian government for their continuous support to our country and their constant collaboration. I express my gratitude to the Italian Ministry of Culture and to the International School of Cultural Heritage for their efforts in preparing this training program. According to the feedback of our delegated team, the program was fruitful, productive, and educational. Through the many lectures and the field work, they were given to the opportunity to develop their skills. The Lebanese Ministry of Culture has several cooperation projects with the Italian government and institutions, among which the restoration works and the World Heritage Site of Baalbek, the rehabilitation of the basement of the National Museum of Beirut, and more recently, after the Beirut explosion, the Unit for Heritage Initiative that helped with the assessment of Beirut's heritage buildings. Having mentioned the Beirut explosion, a point that interests us is to benefit from the Italian experiences on how to reconsider the development of the city. In fact, as we are about to rebuild the destroyed part, we have the chance to reevaluate the previous urban planning in favor of reviving the city, however, keeping its cultural value. As we are currently working on implementing the cultural games in many archaeological sites in Lebanon, one of which is the Seha archaeological site, and considering the work at the CNR consisted of a wider project for the same site that includes the organization and management of the tourist visit, starting with the virtual reality experience, games, creation of a museum, and so on. We hope to combine both projects by continuing our collaboration with the CNR. Based on the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, everyone has the right freely to participate in the cultural life of the community. In order to achieve that, we have to ensure the accessibility of all museums and archaeological sites to people with disabilities, which we have started to implement, especially regarding wheelchair users and blind. Nevertheless, we still have not reached the entire community. Therefore, a possible area of cooperation could be training activities regarding the social inclusion and accessibility. Another interesting point communicated by our delegated team is the public-private sector collaboration and the management of cultural heritage, which proves its efficiency in Italy. Thank you for listening.
Dr. Sarkis, thank you, Dr. Sarkis, for your intervention. We all know how much you have been faced with the explosion of the 4th of August. And you remember that we talked on the 5th of August, and I worked very closely with my colleagues at UNESCO, and you know how UNESCO has taken what happened and the consequences of this explosion, not only for the museums, but also for the inhabitants, for the buildings, and for the urban fabric. So I think you are right in insisting for the forthcoming courses on the aspect of collaboration for the urban planning, for the designing, and for the giving the life to these places which were damaged. The second point, of course, that is an important point for museums, and you have among the best museums in the region, the National Museum, the Sarkis Museum, and the Stone Museums. I think all these museums can benefit during the forthcoming course on how can be improved in terms of new technology, the new system of explanation, particularly for the young people, and also, as you rightly mentioned, for the disabled and in general for the social inclusion to the very rich cultural heritage of Lebanon that, as you know, I visited so many times, and we worked with your department for many, many years for the excavations in the center of the city of Beirut, but also in other sites like Tyre, like Byblos, Baalbek, and Anjar. I think you have such a rich area, like the other speakers mentioned, in this part of the Mediterranean area, that any future effort of training and capacity building is welcomed. Now I want to move to Mrs. Feriel Sharfeddin, director at the Department of Antiquities of Libya. مساء الخير سيدة فريال لك الكلمة.
شكرا سيد منير. تحياتي للجميع. بداية أنقل لكم تحيات سيد رئيس مصلحة الأثار. أنا لست رئيس مصلحة الأثار واعتذاره عن عدم حضور برنامجكم اليوم بسبب التزام مسبق.
كما أشكر كل من كان وراء هذا البرنامج المهم سواء الحكومة الإيطالية على رأسهم طبعا واليونسكو وإدارة المدرسة المحافظة على التراث الثقافي وجميع العاملين فيها ننوه لأهمية الدور اللي كان للممثلين من كل المشاركات للمجموعة اللي شاركت رغم الظروف الصعبة اللي كانت تمر بها بلدي طبعاً لفريق نحن ولكل المجموعات اللي سبب المجموعات الأخرى بسبب عدم انتهاء البرنامج كما كان مقرر له اليوم نأكد لن أضيف الكثير ولكن أؤكد على أهمية مثل هذه البرامج في نقل كل المعرفة وتنمية وتطوير البرامج الخاصة بالحفاظ على التراث الثقافي على مستوى العالم واللي كان دور هام لمشاركتنا من خلال تنمية مهارات في بخصوص ترميم وحفظ الورق وكانت مشاركة ناجحة وجيدة ونشكر المدرسة مركز حفظ الورق اللي كان له دور هام في إثراء هذه التجربة لن أضيف أكثر من أن نتمنى استمرار مثل هذه البرامج ودعمها لكي تنتقل الخبرة للكل وللجميع. شكرا جزيلا
سيدتي فريال على هذا التدخل. نحن نعتبر ليبيا خاصة في الظروف الحالية منطقة ذات أهمية كبرى. We consider, dear colleague, that Libya is in a situation where it is a priority for intervention, for bringing cooperation in the field of training, in the field of capacity building for the monuments, for the museums. And you mentioned also restoration of papers, which was one of the results of the training in the International School of Cultural Heritage. I was honored a few years ago, a long time ago, to be coordinator for the creation of the National Museum in Tripoli. And I know how much you have in terms of objects, work of art, but also in the field of maintaining and restoring the objects in the National Museum in Tripoli, but also in the world sites. Like Lebda, Leptis Magna, Sabrata, Shahat, Sirene. All these sites are really extraordinary heritage. Libya can be proud of it. And I hope that in the present situation where we all hope that peace return definitely to your country, the International School and other institutions like UNESCO, ICOMOS, ICOM, World Monuments Fund, they all are ready to bring cooperation, to bring support for the generation of young specialists in Libya. Shukran jazilan. Thank you so much. Now we move to the next speaker, the director Youssef Khiara from the Ministry of Culture, Youth and Sport and Cultural Heritage in the Kingdom of Morocco. Sayyid Youssef, لك الكلمة. تفضل.
شكرا سيد أمير. بدوري أجدد شكري وامتناني للحكومة الإيطالية على كل المجهودات التي تبذلها في مجال تعاون مرتبط بالآثار والتراث بصفة عامة وخاصة أشكر السيد الوزير الثقافة الإيطالي وكذا السيدة سفيرة إيطاليا بالمملكة المغربية والتي كانت في الحقيقة وراء مشاركة مديرية التراث الثقافي بأحد ممثليها في هذه الدورة كما أشكر القيمين على المدرسة الدولية للآثار لحسن الاستضافة ولقيمة التكوين الذي تلقته المتربصة التي مثلت المغرب. بداية لابد لي من أتطرق للنقطة الأولى وهي تقييم يعني محصلة التكوين الذي استفادت منه ممثلة المغرب في هذه الدورة. وإن كنا نتمنى أن يكون عدد يعني الممثلين للمغرب أكثر من فرد أو فردين اعتبارا للقيمة العالية التي لاحظناها في المواضيع التي تم تكوين فيها. فنحن يعني راضون كل الرضا على التكوين الذي تلقته المتمرنة المغربية. ولا أدل على ذلك من أنها بمجرد عودتها للمغرب باشرت يعني مهامها بمقاربة جديدة وخبرة جديدة تنم عن مدى جدية ورصانة التكوين بالمدرسة الدولية للآثار بإيطاليا. بالنسبة لمجال التعاون، فالتعاون المغربي الإيطالي بصفة عامة هو عريق ومتنوع وغني، لكن المجالات التي نحبذ ونتمنى أن يتم يعني التركيز عليها بالنسبة للمغرب، بداية هناك مسألة تكوين المكونين في مجال محاربة الاتجار غير المشروع بالممتلكات الثقافية. ولإيطاليا تجربة مع شرطة كارابينيري التي كانت لدى تجربة معها اقتسمت معنا بعض خبرتها، ولكن لم تستمر. ونتمنى أن يتم إعادة هذا التكوين. وتعلمون بأن محاربة الاتجار غير المشروع بالممتلكات الثقافية من المسائل التي ركز عليها السياسة وإدارة التراث في المغرب. وقد ربما سمعتم مؤخرا بأن المغرب استعاد مؤخرا قرابة 25,000 قطعة من فرنسا، فبالتالي هذا من الأولويات التي نركز عليها في سياساتنا هو تدبير التراث الثقافي في المغرب. النقطة التالية نحب أن نركز عليها أيضا هو مجال توثيق التراث الثقافي من خلال اعتماد تطبيقات وبرامج المعلوميات الرقمية، خاصة توثيق ثلاثي الأبعاد المعالم والمواقع الأركيولوجية. ونعتقد بأن حادث حريق الذي ألم بكاتدرائية نوتر دام دو باري في فرنسا كان درسا للجميع، حيث أن مسألة التوثيق أصبحت الآن ضرورة ماسة لتفادي ضياع معطيات ومعلومات خاصة بالمواقع الأثرية بصفة عامة والمعالم التاريخية. هناك اهتمام أيضا متزايد وأولوية أخرى وهو التراث المغمور بالمياه، والذي ربما ننساه أحيانا. ولإيطاليا أيضا هنا تجربة رائدة على المستوى الدولي وعلى مستوى البحر الأبيض المتوسط، نتمنى أن تتقاسمها معنا من خلال التكوين ونقل الخبرة والتكنولوجيا المرتبطة بهذا المجال. هناك جانب آخر وهو تطوير التراث العالمي للمغرب. عدة مواقع مصنفة تراثا عالميا، أغلبيتها مدن عتيقة ونسيج عمراني تاريخي. واعتبارا يعني الضغط متزايد على المواقع الحية لأنها آهلة بالسكان من خلال بناء يعني المنشآت المعمارية والبنية التحتية، هناك بعض الصعوبات في تدبير مسألة يعني التطور العمراني وكذا المحافظة على التراث. ولإيطاليا أيضا هنا تجربة يمكن أن نستلهم منها يعني حتى يتسنى لنا المحافظة على هذا التراث وتلبية حاجيات الساكنة. نقطتين أخيرتين قبل أن أختم وهو مسألة التراث والتنمية المستدامة. المغرب مقبل وقد شرع في ورش كبير وهو يعني الجهوية المتقدمة في جهات مختلف جهات المغرب. ومن منظورنا فالتراث يشكل أحد أعمدة التنمية المحلية، يعني تكوين يعني المنتخبين المحليين والقيمين على تدبير الشأن المحلي يعتبر ركيزة أساسية للمحافظة على التراث. ونتمنى أيضا هنا أن يكون هناك يعني تلبية لهذا الطلب والتعاون في هذا المجال للرفع من قدرات المنتخبين والمحليين في تسيير شؤون يعني جماعاتهم التي ترابية التي يشرفون عليها. في الأخير عندنا مسألة في الوزارة في المغرب تم دمج وزارة الثقافة والشباب، وهنا تبرز أهمية التربية على التراث التي تشكل إحدى الأوراش الكبرى التي تم فتحها، فلا يمكن الحفاظ على التراث الثقافي بصفة عامة دون يعني التركيز على جانب التوعية لدى الشباب. فالوساطة الثقافية في هذا المجال والتكوين في مجال فعاليات المجتمع المدني يعتبر من الركائز التي يجب تطويرها. إذا كان هذا في خلاصة يعني شديدة اهتمامات يعني المغرب بمسألة التعاون مع إيطاليا. وفي الأخير أجدد شكري لكل القيمين على هذا التكوين وعلى إعداد هذا اللقاء التشاوري، وشكرا.
شكرا شكرا جزيلا أخ العزيز دكتور يوسف خيارة على هذا التدخل القيم. I want to express my thanks also to your intervention and the points that you raised. First of all, the satisfaction about the training of one expert in the field of heritage. And you expressed also the wish that more participants could be invited for this training. And you expressed also a number of points which are of all of importance. You mentioned, of course, the work of Carabinieri per la tutela del patrimonio culturale. This is a unique experience in the world where a part of the army is in charge of the identification and then the follow-up of objects which are stolen or illicitly exported from the country. The documentation and the inventory of archaeological sites, a field that you are the only one have evoked up to now, the underwater archaeology and the application of the UNESCO Convention of 2001. But also, this is in all countries. It's not only in Morocco, because I worked, as you know, in Fez, in Marrakech, in Meknes, and also in the south, in Ouarzazate. You have, as in many other countries, what we call the urban pressure. And here, yes, we can benefit from the experience of the Italian sites which are on the World Heritage List and which are cities, and how in Italy the application of the management of archaeological and urban sites is followed. And finally, the awareness. This is a very important point, the awareness of the young people, the young generation to the heritage. Thank you so much for your intervention. The next speaker is my colleague and friend Ahmed Drjoub, Director General of the World Heritage Unit in Palestine, Ministry of Tourism and Antiquities. Dr. Ahmed, you have the floor. تفضل أخي العزيز.
شكراً 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 جزيلاً دكتور منير. يعني جزيل الشكر لك لإدارة هذه الجلسة بداية، وأنا سعيد جداً يعني أن أراك لو افتراضياً يعني، وسعيد جداً كمان أن أرى جميع زملائي في هذا اللقاء، ونتمنى السلامة للجميع أولاً، وإن شاء الله بيكون عندنا فرصة أن نلتقي وجاهة يعني قريباً، وإن شاء الله في 21 يعني بيكون هذا اللقاء. يعني أود بداية يعني أن أستغل هذه الفرصة لأشكر المؤسسة الدولية للآثار طبعا في والحكومة الإيطالية لتنظيم هذه الدورة وهذا التكوين المهم، وأشكر كمان جميع المؤسسات حقيقة الإيطالية أيضا اللي ساهمت في إنجاح هذه التجربة. والحقيقة يعني شكر كله دائما وجميعه للحكومة الإيطالية اللي دائما بتدعم برامج التكوين وبتدعم كمان الحفاظ على التراث الثقافي يعني خاصة في فلسطين والدول حوض البحر الأبيض المتوسط بشكل عام. الحقيقة تقييمنا احنا لهذه التجربة يعني هو خاصة من خلال المشاركين، احنا بالمناسبة كان عندنا مشاركين اثنين من فلسطين في هذا التكوين، وطبعا التقييم هو تقييم ايجابي جدا، والحقيقة من اكثر من ناحية سواء الجانب العلمي النظري والجانب كمان الميداني ومن خلال الزيارات للاطلاع على التجربة الإيطالية. بعتقد يعني الكل وجميعنا بيجمع على انه التراث سواء في فلسطين او في منطقة البحر الأبيض المتوسط بشكل عام مهم لهذه المنطقة، واحنا كمان نعرف انه يعني الآن نتحدث عن فلسطين لا يوجد فيها موارد طبيعية ولكن هي غنية بتراثها سواء التراث الثقافي، التراث الديني، التراث الطبيعي. وفلسطين يعني نجحت خاصة يعني في الآونة الأخيرة انه تحافظ على جزء كبير من هذا التراث، وتم تسجيل مواقع على قائمة التراث العالمي ايضا. ولكن يعني التراث بشكل عام سواء التراث الثقافي، التراث الطبيعي، التراث دائما بواجه تحديات، والتحديات هاي سواء كانت على المستوى التقني او على المستوى المادي. يعني للاسف هناك حاجه دائما ملحه لدعم الخبرات الفنيه وتنفيذها بمصادر ماليه، وهذه المصادر الماليه على الاغلب غير متوفره. علشان لذا يعني احنا بنتحدث يعني برامج تكوينيه مثل هذا البرنامج اللي تم طبعا تنفيذه من قبل المدرسه الدوليه مهم على المستوى الدولي والمستوى الاقليمي بشكل خاص لدعم الخبرات المحليه. وفي نفس الوقت يعني ممكن احنا كمان لما نتحدث عن التشالنجز او الجانب المالي للاستفاده من هذه التجارب، يعني ممكن كمان برامج تكوينيه من هذا النوع انها تقلل التكلفة المحلية، بحيث انه المتدربين، واحنا شاكرين جدا لهذا البرنامج انه ساهم في حقيقة نقل هذه الخبرة من إيطاليا من خلال المؤسسة الإيطالية الموجودة إلى فلسطين، وهذا يعني مهم جدا، وهذا ممكن يوفر الصراحة موارد مالية ضخمة لفلسطين. على كل حال يعني أنا يعني ما بدي أكرر اللي ذكر من قبل زملائي، ولكن بدي أحكي على المستوى الاستراتيجي أكثر في هذا الجانب. يعني واضح أنه من اطلاعنا على هاي التجربة ومن اطلاعنا على ما قدمته المؤسسات الإيطالية في هاي الندوة، هناك حقيقة إمكانيات ضخمة سواء في إيطاليا أو في الدول البحر الأبيض المتوسط بشكل عام اللي ممكن الاستفادة منها. وبعتقد أنه يعني لابد أنه نستفيد من التجارب الموجودة، يعني خاصة ما يتعلق بالشراكة ما بين المجتمع، سواء نحكي عن المجتمعات المحلية. الجانب الآخر والمهم كمان تنمية الشراكة ما بين القطاع العام والخاص، وهذا بعتقد كثير كثير مهم، يعني خاصة يعني في هذه المنطقة اللي ما زالت تعتمد على القطاع العام في تنمية المواقع التراث الثقافي، وفي نفس الوقت في الحفاظ عليها وترويجها. ويعني بجزء التجربة الفلسطينية في هذا الموضوع كانت يعني خاصة أنه نتحدث عن النقص في الموارد المالية، ممكن أن تكون الشراكة مع القطاع الخاص في هذا الموضوع، وإدارة التراث الثقافي بالشراكة مع القطاع الخاص ممكن يكون حل حل لهذا الموضوع وفي هذا الجانب بتوقع كمان انه التجربة الإيطالية كمان غنية في هذا الموضوع وتجارب الدول الأخرى فياريت انه يتم التركيز كمان على هذا الموضوع بحيث انه احنا نتجاوز الشورتج او النقص في الموارد الماليه من خلال القطاع الخاص. الامر الثاني الاستراتيجي اللي انا بتحكي عنه هو التخطيط، يعني انه احنا كمان يتم التركيز على 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 التخطيط لاداره التراث والحفاظ عليه وفي نفس الوقت ترويجه، يعني اذا كان هناك تخطيط صح بعتقد انه احنا ممكن نصل لنتائج صحيحه وخاصه اذا احنا بناخذ تجربه جائحه كورونا كوفيد 19 اللي كمان يعني جعلتنا ان نفكر في امور ثانيه، في امور او بدائل اخرى، يعني وهذا كمان بجعلنا ان نفكر في الاولويات، شو الاولويات اللي احنا كمان المفروض نركز عليها. يعني زملائي ذكروا الجانب الرقمي او الديجيتال، والديجيتال حقيقه كثير كثير صفه مهم، وهو بوفر بالمناسبه كمان موارد ماليه، خاصه طبعا موارد ماليه ممكن تنفق على التراث، لانه احنا يعني بنتحدث عن التوثيق على سبيل المثال، بنتحدث عن الترويج، بنتحدث عن اظهار هذه المواقع، يعني اليوم التقنيات الرقميه ممكن تساعدنا كثير في هذا الموضوع، وممكن كمان يعني حتى تقلل الفجوه ما بين القائمين على إدارة التراث وفي نفس الوقت المجتمعات المحلية الموجودة، وخاصة احنا بنحكي عن نقل المعرفة، عن نقل التجربة، عن نقل هاي، يعني ممكن ان تساعدنا كثير. اللي بدي كمان اذكره في هذا الموضوع وذكر طبعا بس بدي يعني اركز عليه اكثر، اللي هي التشاركية والتكامل في ما بين الدول في هذه المنطقة. يعني الحقيقة يعني تجربتنا في هاي البرنامج، هذا البرنامج التكويني اللي صار هو كان تجربة منيحة وتجربة بجد يعني رائعة، ولكن يعني احنا يعني ممكن نطور كمان هاي التجربة أكثر شوي، بمعنى انه إذا بيتم يعني سواء المدرسة الدولية للآثار أو ممكن يكون على المستوى الإقليمي، ممكن يكون تحت مظلة اليونسكو، إنه يكون عندنا تجربة أو قاعدة بيانات للخبرات الموجودة هاي أو الخبراء، خليني أحكي، بحيث إنه يعني بدل ما إحنا نبعث متدربين على روما ولا على إيطاليا، إنه إحنا ممكن نستفيد من يعني يصير تبادل ما بين الخبراء نفسهم. يعني على سبيل المثال أنا بحكي يعني عندنا مثلا مشكلة إحنا في فلسطين علاقة بترميم الماد بريك على سبيل المثال في تل السلطان وإلى آخره، يعني في حال إحنا احتجنا خبير ممكن هذا الخبير بشكل تبادلي انه يجي عندنا في فلسطين لمده مثلا شهر شهرين ثلاث يعمل تدريب للكوادر المحليه، فبالتالي احنا بنبني هذه الخبرات والى اخره. يعني هذا موضوع كثير كثير مهم. النقطه الاخيره يعني اللي بدي اشير لها، يعني احنا كمان يعني عانينا في فلسطين كثير من قصة سرقة الأثار وتحريب الأثار، وياريت كمان يعني هذا الموضوع يعني آلية الحفاظ على هذا على 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 المواقع الأثرية ومحاربة سرقة الأثار وتهريبها، يعني بتصور هذا كمان موضوع كثير كثير مهم، وهذا بحاجة لتعاون إقليمي ودولي حقيقة لضبط هذا الموضوع، ولا يمكن لأي دولة من هاي الدول إنها تقوم لوحدها بهذا الموضوع، بالعكس هذا بحاجة كمان إلى تعاون إقليمي ودولي. وفي النهاية يعني بشكركم جميعا، وبأشكر طبعا المؤسسة الدولية والحكومة اللي طلع هذا الموضوع، وإحنا يعني بأكد إنه ما زلنا في بداية الطريق، ونحن بحاجة إلى مثل هذه البرامج وبحاجة للتعاون أكثر وتعاون عملي على أرض الواقع. شكرا لكم، أعطيكم العافية.
شكرا أخي أحمد على هذا التدخل القيم والتفصيلي. Thank you so much for this intervention. It is of course important to note and for our colleagues
particularly the director Alessandra Vittorini and Franca Miglioli, to note that there is a positive evaluation for the participation of Palestinian trainees in within this course, but he opened also the proposals to, first of all, a strategic vision about cooperation between countries, about the facing the challenges that Palestinian sites are facing, and particularly the lack of financial resources. And he opened an avenue with the, what we call public-private partnership for cultural heritage, and also the question of planning this action with the private committees, with the supporters, either national or international. And finally, of course, like it was said by our colleague from Morocco, the question of illicit traffic of cultural heritage, where Italy has such an important experience. Thank you again for your contribution. Last but not least, my dear friend and colleague, Dr. Fawzi Mahfoud, Director General of the National Center for Archaeological Research in Tunisia. دكتور فوزي مساء الخير والكلمة إليك صديقي وأخي العزيز.
شكرا جزيلا أخي وصديقي العزيز دكتور منير بوشناقي، وأنا مسرور برؤيتك وأتمنى أن أراك في أقرب وقت ممكن في تونس أو في أي مكان آخر. أود أن أتوجه بالشكر إلى المدرسة الدولية للتراث الثقافي في إيطاليا ولكل القائمين على هذه الندوة وكل السادة والسيدات المتدخلين وكل الأخوة من مختلف البلدان الذين استمعت إلى مداخلاتهم القيمة. أود أن أقول في البداية أن تونس شاركت بباحثين متميزين في هذه في هذا التكوين الخاص الذي امتد أكثر من 5 أشهر، ومع كامل الأسف ظهور الكورونا أدت إلى تقليص المدة، ولكن أعتقد أن الإفادة كانت حاصلة وكانت إفادة متميزة حسب التقارير التي وصلتني من زميلي. الإفادة في مستوى التكوين في حد تكوين جد وتكوين عميق، الزيارات الميدانية المتعددة. نحن لدينا شراكة قديمة مع إيطاليا منذ الاستقلال تقريبا، هنالك باستمرار دورات تكوينية وتعاون وثيق في مجال التراث الثقافي الأثري، ومشاركتنا في هذه الدورة تأتي من رغبتنا في تعميق انتمائنا إلى هذا المحيط، هذا المجال الذي ننتمي إليه بكل فخر. أيضا رغبتنا في إيجاد حلول مشتركة ما بيننا وبين الدول التي لها تراث ثري مثل ما لدينا في بلادنا، وكذلك في تكوين إطارات لها مستوى عالي من الكفاءات، وهذا ما نحرص عليه دائما وأبدا. الموضوع المطروح كان موضوعا هاما جدا، هو التحديات وكذلك الاستراتيجيات المستقبلية، وهذا هام جدا لأن لا يمكن لأي دولة بمفردها أن تتولى بمفردها شؤون تراثها في بلدها بمفردها. فمسألة التراث بطبيعة الحال إنسانية، ولكن أيضا مسألة على الأقل تهم الإقليم الذي ننتمي إليه، وبدون أدنى شك لابد من أن نأخذ اعتبار خصوصيات لكل بلد، خصوصيات ثقافية، خصوصيات سياسية، تحفظات اجتماعية وكل دولة لها أن تحدد أولوياتها. نحن في الحقيقة مع هذه الجائحة الجديدة والطارئة جائحة الكوفيد أصبحت لدينا تحديات كبيرة في تونس. تعلمون جيدا تونس دولة بامتياز وأن السياحة تمثل جزء هام من المدخول السنوي للدولة التونسية، وما نلاحظه نتيجة هذه الجائحة هو انحدار كامل وانخفاض كامل في مستوى الزيارات وفي مستوى قدوم السياح وحتى في مستوى السياحة الداخلية، وأدى هذا بطبيعة الحال إلى تدهور خطير في مستوى العائدات، وفي المقابل هنالك تزايد في مستوى النفقات بما في ذلك النفقات لمكافحة الجائحة، وهذا يطرح أمامنا تحديات جديدة لم نكن متعودين عليها ولم نكن ننتظرها، لأن المسألة مفاجئة بالنسبة لنا، ولابد على الأقل الآن، وهذا هو التوجه الذي نسير نحوه، وهو ربما تنمية السياحة الداخلية لتقليص وتخفيض الأزمة بالنسبة لبلدان السياحة الخارجية، وكذلك لابد من استمرارية المرفق العمومي، لأن المعهد الوطني للتراث كما تعلمون هو يحافظ على التراث، وبالتالي لابد من استمرارية المحافظة على مواقعنا الأثرية، على متاحفنا، على مخازننا. هذا في ظرف يبدو أن الأمور أكثر تشعب مما كانت عليه من قبل، نتيجة خاصة منع الجولان، نتيجة حظر التجول، كل تحديات جديدة مكافحة ذلك من يغتنم الفرصة وللإدارة بالأمر علينا مزيد الجهد في الوقوف أمام كل هذه التظاهرات وأمام كل هذه التجاوزات التي ربما تمثل خطر بالنسبة إلينا. هنالك أيضا مشاكل كبرى في الحقيقة في مستوى التسيير اليوم، وهذا يعني مسائل حقيقية، لأن الأوضاع تغيرت، ومع ذلك نحن نحاول أن لا نعطل المواطن، يعني الكثير كما تعلمون من رخص البناء، من كذلك من رخص المقاطع تمر عبر مصالحنا، ونتيجة تقلص العمل الإداري كل هذا يفرض علينا أكثر مجاعة، ويفرض علينا أن نحافظ على الحد الأدنى وأن لا نقوم بتعطيل المواطنين وتعطيل الشأن العام. هنالك تحديات كبيرة، وهنالك هذا من باب على الأقل العمل الاستراتيجي، لابد أن ننظر في خطة كاملة ربما تحت غطاء اليونسكو أو تحت غطاء الدول التي لها فئات كبرى للنهوض، وعلى الأقل الحد من نتائج الجائحة على دولنا وعلى تراثنا بالتحديد. وكذلك لابد أن نراجع، نحن في تونس بدأنا وشرعنا في هذا في بخصوص التشريعات الوطنية، بدأنا نراجعها في أيضا الجرد الوطني، لابد أن بدأنا نقوم بهذا، وفي هذا هنالك خطة استراتيجية. يبدو أننا في الحقيقة نحن في تونس بدأنا نميز بين فترتين، فترة ما قبل الكورونا وتحديات هيكلية أساسية نحن لازلنا نواجهها، وفترة ما بعد الكورونا أرجو أن تكون هذه التحديات طارئة وأن تمر بسلام، ولكن لا يمكن لأي دولة من الدول أن تقوم بمفردها.
صوت راح الصوت.
شكر السيد المترجم الذي حقيقة أبدى جهدا كبيرا وكانني على الاستمتاع بمداخلتكم وشكرا سيد الرئيس.
شكرا شكرا جزيلا دكتور محفوظ على هذا التدخل الرائع. I want to thank you for a very, very detailed presentation of the situation all the countries and also Tunisia are facing with the virus corona and the consequences on cultural heritage. And you showed that the training that was done with the international school is in line with the long experience of cooperation with Italy, between Italy and Tunisia. And I must say that I personally benefited in 1965 of a training in the field of archaeology with Italian team from Rome University in Tunisia. So this is something that is important to mention. The importance of tourism with cultural heritage and the fact that, of course, this COVID has impacted what was, generally speaking, in Tunisia, a very important cultural tourism. Now they have to revise the strategy on tourism development and also see how, in terms of legislation, they have to draw some lessons about the consequences of COVID. But in general, he mentioned, Dr. Fauzi, he mentioned that the cooperation, national cooperation, international cooperation, and the work that could be done is highly appreciated. So thank you, Dr. Fauzi. And the last speaker is from Turkey, Gohan Yazgi from Turkey. Please, Dr. Gohan, you are Director General in the General Directorate of Heritage and Museum. I was happy to meet you only a few weeks ago in Istanbul, and I am pleased to give you the floor in this very important forum. Please, you have the floor, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Munir. And ladies and gentlemen, the other directors, it's an honor and a great pleasure for me to participate in this online closing seminar of the program 29-22 of the International School of the Cultural Heritage. I would like to take this opportunity to express my heartfelt thanks to the Italian Minister of Culture and Tourism, and especially to the Foundation for generously hosting and all participants of the program in Italy during the training program and for their excellent organizations of the program. I believe that the lectures provided in Rome, which included almost all subjects related to the conversations, production, and the management of cultural heritage properties and complement with the visits to the institutions specialists in this area, have provided participants and vast knowledge on cultural heritage production and management. Ladies and gentlemen, we are ready to cooperate with the Foundation and other Italian institutions in any kind of cultural cooperation project, including things to be realized with institutions involved in the International School of Cultural Heritage program for skills exchange. We would be glad to host Italian professionals in our country for thematic workshop on cultural heritage production and management. As for the online webinar courses planned to be implemented in the short term, we could recommend some subjects such as private conversations and planets, maintains service in archaeological space. Online platforms create for protection of cultural heritage and providing coordination among public institutions working in the heritage sector. The involvement of private sector in management of archaeological sites and museums and the use of digital techniques in both archaeological sites and museums to enhance the visitor experience. Finally, hope that this meeting entails more strengthened collaborations process for cultural heritage protection and the management among participating countries. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, dear Director General, for your intervention. As all participants here know, how Turkey is rich in terms of cultural heritage, whether tangible or intangible. And as I said, only a few weeks ago, I was with you to discuss one important item concerning the cultural heritage in Istanbul. I am sure, Mr. Director General, that my colleagues and my friends in charge of the International School of Cultural Heritage have taken note of you know, the main trends that you mentioned in your intervention, which is conservation of archaeological sites. And you know, Turkey has an experience of more than a century of international teams working in Ephesus, working in Troy, working in many very important archaeological sites, but also in heritage, urban heritage sites. A number of them are on the World Heritage List. And you mentioned very rightly, you know, the question of management. Yesterday, I was speaking before this session with my colleagues, and in particular with His Excellency Ambassador Meloni, who will make the conclusion to this presentation. And you have seen that all the speakers, and you were among them, you insisted on the fact of the importance of taking into consideration the question of management and training for having proper specialists in management of World Heritage sites, of archaeological sites, on urban sites, and the topic of collaboration in the field of cultural heritage. So I cannot, I don't want to take too much time because we are a bit behind schedule. I wanted only to thank again Signor Marcello Minuti, of course, His Excellency, the Minister of Cultural Heritage and Activities, His Excellency Dario Franceschini, who attended this session, and all the experts who made very, very valuable interventions. What I must say with my modest experience is that this course is having a very important impact in terms of knowledge and scientific approach. It has a very important vision on the importance of work in situ for experts who have already an experience in their country, but who can see on the spot in Italy, again, a country having a long experience in the field of conservation, preservation, and promotion of cultural heritage. And thirdly, the importance of collaboration and cooperation. Whatever is the political situation, my point of view when I was in UNESCO, when I was in ICRAM, is to make sure that cultural heritage is above political problems, that cultural heritage is a human legacy. It's not for a nation, it's not for a country, it's for all human beings. And that's why I think the philosophy that you are presenting in the course, and I hope also in the future course, will take into account this question of human relations between specialists, between experts, which will, when they return, each of them in their countries, constitute a link. There will be a bridge after the course
between those who have been in Italy and those who are coming from either Maghreb or Mashreq. I think this is very important, or even Ethiopia. I was very pleased to listen also to our colleague from Ethiopia. I think this, this session was for me a very important moment of listening, of taking notes, and of course, we will have the chance, hopefully, to have a meeting ad personam. Thank you so much for your attention. And my apologies if we didn't respect exactly the 7 minutes by intervenants.
Grazie
Thank
mille
you,
davvero.
Mr. Marcello Minuti. Grazie mille, grazie a tutti i colleghi ed amici italiani che hanno organizzato veramente una sessione meravigliosa. Grazie mille.
Grazie, guardi, non ci sono parole davvero per ringraziarla, le nostre aspettative erano alte, lei è riuscita a superarle di molto. E quindi siamo impressionati dalla sua conoscenza del mondo, di quest'area del mondo, del tema, delle persone. Grazie davvero. Speriamo ci possano essere presto nuove occasioni, Messie Bujnaki. Prima di passare la parola allora all'ambasciatore Meloni, il direttore mi prega di ringraziare a fine di questa giornata una persona molto importante per la Fondazione, Carla Di Francesco, che probabilmente è ancora collegata. Carla Di Francesco è stata direttore per 2 anni della nostra fondazione e quindi è stata l'artefice forse più di tutti noi che oggi abbiamo parlato di questo evento. Franca Miglioli, che è la nostra consulente per l'area internazionale, che è stata a più riprese nominata, e infine una persona, diciamo, a fare gruppo di tutti i collaboratori della fondazione, che è vicino a me, Ninetta Cagliazza, e diciamo la responsabile di quello che possiamo dire è stato un piccolo successo organizzativo. Passerei quindi la parola all'ambasciatore Meloni per le conclusioni. Grazie.
Grazie, veramente brevissime, alla fine di una lunga sessione, devo dire, se posso parlare in nome della scuola, che la presenza dei massimi responsabili dei paesi partner oggi ci ha onorato, ci ha dato una grande forza per portare avanti le nostre azioni. Io direi solo 2-3 cose. Uno, una mia breve valutazione su alcuni aspetti mi sembra evidenti, cioè che il programma dello scorso anno è stato apprezzato da tutti. C'è stato un invito quasi generale a vedere di ripeterlo quando ci saranno le condizioni. Proposta di metodo, io penso che la scuola potrà essere in grado entro il gennaio del 2021 di presentare, sulla base della discussione che abbiamo avuto oggi, un concetto per la prossima edizione del programma, che immagino si potrà fare probabilmente all'inizio del 2022. Vedremo come funziona naturalmente la pandemia. Quindi, e su questa proposta richiederemo dei commenti e delle osservazioni da parte dei partecipanti. La seconda cosa è che evidentemente c'è una parte di ora di lavoro durante la pandemia. Abbiamo preso bene nota di quello che è stato detto sull'affollamento dell'offerta in webinar e quindi faremo il possibile per avere veramente un'offerta di nicchia ritagliata sulle vostre necessità, e su questo speriamo di poter fare delle proposte anche entro la fine dell'anno, se siamo in grado di farlo. Infine, io credo che di aver constatato un grande interesse nella formula gemellaggi quando anche questo sarà possibile, e quindi sarà compito della scuola lavorare in questi mesi per poter approntare una proposta che sarà naturalmente su base bilaterale ma anche su base regionale, in qualche misura, come è stato da molti richiesto. Infine vorrei dire che cerchiamo di mantenere quello che è stato evidente a tutti gli interventi, cioè che quello che è utile è fare della formazione, non informazione, per cui una delle caratteristiche sarà di mantenere una certa durata delle nostre iniziative, fare in modo che le persone possano, quando sarà il momento, rimanere insieme, fare un lavoro insieme e rafforzare questi legami umani, personali, ma anche di istituzioni, che poi, come tutti gli oratori hanno detto, sono una delle cose più importanti. E infine, ancora una cosa che naturalmente cercheremo di farlo come sempre, appoggiandoci anche collaborando con grandi istituzioni come UNESCO, come ICROM e come ICOM. Queste sono le mie poche parole. Alla fine, poi naturalmente, come sappiamo, faremo circolare, diciamo, il video della riunione e la scuola farà anche una specie di sintesi per dare una valutazione propria del convegno che distribuiremo poi a tutti i partner. Molte grazie.
Bene, siamo arrivati alla conclusione di questa giornata. Grazie ambasciatore Andrea Meloni. Grazie a voi tutti. Faremo sì circolare una nota scritta degli esiti principali di questo incontro, così come metteremo a disposizione di tutti quanti noi. Eccoci qua. Il video di questo incontro. Da parte mia non mi resta che salutare tutti, ringraziare di nuovo e darci appuntamento dal vivo nel 2021. Grazie.